beliefs that have kept her going for the last 11 years in Downing Street. She told the Cabinet this morning that she had decided not to contest the second round of the Conservative leadership contest for the sake of what she called party unity and their prospects at the general election. Two Cabinet colleagues have declared that they are to stand in that contest. The Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd, who's been nominated by the Defence Secretary Tom King and seconded by the Environment Secretary Chris Patten. And the Chancellor of the Exchequer, John Major, who's been nominated by the Agriculture Minister, John Gummer, and seconded by the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, Norman Lamont. They will contest the leadership with the third contender, Michael Heseltine, of course, who said that he welcomes the Prime Minister's decision to step aside and open up the contest. Mrs. Thatcher left Downing Street to go to Buckingham Palace to formally tell the Queen of her decision to stand down from the Prime Ministership and not to contest the party leadership in the second ballot at 12:34. She'd spent the morning phoning many world leaders to inform them of her decision, and there has been the first reaction from world capitals to that decision. There she is, arriving at Buckingham Palace, where she had that formal meeting with the Queen to tell her of her decision. Some of that first reaction from world leaders. The Soviet Union has said that the resignation of the British Prime Minister has surprised the Soviet Union. It says that she enjoyed widespread popularity as a strong leader in this country who stood up for her country's national interests. The Soviet Union statement has said that it was a surprise. In our imagination, she was the Iron Lady who would fight to the end, the Soviet Foreign Ministry spokesman Gennady Gerasimov said. They went on to say that we will remember her as someone who made a great contribution to the good relations between the Soviet Union and the continent. She was a historic figure who helped bring the Soviet Union closer to Europe. Well, the Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd has said that he is very sad that the Prime Minister has resigned. He made a statement of tribute at the Cabinet meeting this morning, which heard of her decision. He was the first person to speak after the Prime Minister.
Opportunity to ask and answer questions before the weekend, but I just wanted to make one or two points clear. The Prime Minister announced a very sad decision this morning. I believe the overriding need now is for the Conservative Party to find a leader who can unite it in handling present problems and in winning the next general election. That's the message coming in from Conservatives in all parts of the party, all parts of the country. Division can spell disaster. I believe that I can do that, and that is why I'm putting my name forward. I can believe that I can unite the party in handling present problems and in winning the next general election. We've got, as a country, hard tests ahead of us at home, in Europe, and in the Gulf. And all Conservatives believe that we have a strong duty to the country to prevent the election of a Labour government under Neil Kinnock, who is the most lightweight Labour leader there's ever been. Can I just add two further points? I supported the Prime Minister fully until the moment of her decision this morning. Indeed, yesterday evening, I signed the nomination paper, which would have enabled her to go forward today had she decided to do so. What we've got to do now is build on her successes. I understand that John Major is putting forward his name also today. He and I have kept in very close touch throughout this contest, and indeed we've just issued a few minutes ago a joint statement about the contest. We've worked together in the past, we shall work together in the future. He is and he will remain a good friend and a strong colleague.
Well, Mr. Hurd and Mr. Major have said that they can engage in a friendly contest for the leadership. The Chancellor, John Major, was the last contender to submit his nomination papers just before noon this morning. He emerged from the Treasury at lunchtime with his wife, Thelma, to give interviews to waiting journalists, and he said that he too would like an opportunity to unite the Conservative Party.
Well, let me say firstly that I'm extremely sorry that the Prime Minister has decided to resign. She had my full support in the first ballot. I had seconded her for the second ballot, and I'm sorry that she has taken the decision in the interests of unity and the party that she is not to go on. I think she will be seen by history as a very great Prime Minister indeed, with a very considerable number of achievements. I think our job now is to try and build on those achievements. I believe I would like the opportunity of trying to unite the party. A lot of colleagues have suggested to me that I may be able to do so. And so I have decided to let my name go forward in the ballot for leadership of the Conservative Party. It is now a matter for my colleagues to decide.
Sir? Mr. Major, have you and Mr. Hurd both decided to stand before Mr. Hurd on the third ballot?
No, that is not the position at all. Mr. Hurd has made his own decision to stand, and I have made my own decision to stand. We both have a very high admiration for one another, but that is an individual decision that one has to make.
Are you confident?
Thank you very much indeed.
Are you confident winning, Mr. Major?
Well, I think that is a matter for my parliamentary colleagues. I hope that what happens is that the Conservative Party wins, that it has a leader who can unite the Conservative Party and win the next general election. I believe that is wholly possible. I think that is the first prize for all of us. That is what all the candidates in the field will wish to see, and every Conservative Member of Parliament will wish to see. It is certainly what I will endeavour to do.
Do you think Sterling will win because of the leadership contest?
Well, we will have to see what happens to Sterling. I hope Sterling will be robust. We are now members of the exchange rate mechanism. We have commitments to maintain the value of Sterling. We will meet those commitments.
The Chancellor, John Major, well, the third contender for the leadership, the man who started the whole process off, Michael Heseltine, has said very little. He did, however, welcome the Prime Minister's decision to step aside, since he said that it opened the way for an election for the vacancy of leadership of the Conservative Party, which will enable others to come forward. Well, since he said that, those two others, the Chancellor and the Foreign Secretary, have indeed come forward. It is a three-horse race. In Downing Street now is our political correspondent, John Sopel. John, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Nick.
What do we know about how the Prime Minister is feeling? She left Downing Street a short time ago, didn't she, to the House of Commons?
She left Downing Street a few moments ago. She smiled broadly for the cameras, took a long while to get into her car so that everyone got the photos that they were after. She didn't look ruffled at all, but clearly this will be a very sad day for her. She normally spends a lunchtime like this working on the sort of questions that are going to be fired at her aggressively in the Commons. And now she's going to deliver the speech, which will probably be her last speech as Prime Minister in the no-confidence debate later this afternoon. As it must be a sad day for her, and not least for her advisers who've worked very closely with her, who've become identified with her. And I'm sure it's hard to see how some of the advisers who've been very close to her can carry on now.
That speech that she will deliver this afternoon to rebut the opposition's motion of no confidence will, one imagines, have been as carefully prepared as are most of her speeches, but it has, of course, taken on this greater significance now, hasn't it?
It has indeed. I think she would have, if she was fighting the second round, have had a rather difficult reception from Conservative MPs, and Labour MPs would have certainly tried to exploit every division and difficulty that they faced. As it is, I think when the Prime Minister walks into the chamber this afternoon, probably just before Prime Minister's questions, there'll be the most enormously warm reception from her, from all Conservative MPs, even those who voted against her, because they believe now that she has made the right decision in opening the way up for Douglas Hurd and John Major to enter the contest.
There is great relief within the Cabinet, I think, within the party, that this process is now moving on, but there's also great sadness, isn't there? The Home Secretary, David Waddington, has said that the farewell with the Prime Minister this morning was the saddest moment of his life.
I think there's enormous sadness, and I think from the right of the party, actually, that there is no relief at all. There's absolute fury. Last night I was in the lobbies, and they'd all been meeting in their groups. The 92 group had met. Large numbers of people on the right believed that with John Wakeham having been installed as to become the campaign manager, they now had the fight back on their hands. And I spoke to a number of them late in the night, and they were saying, right, we're back on the rails now. Mrs. Thatcher's going to win the second round. There's no question of her quitting. The advice she's had from her close political friends is to carry on. But obviously the advice of others to give up has weighed more heavily, and there is deep resentment, actually, from a number of MPs on the right of the party who don't see how the party can unite without anyone but Mrs. Thatcher.
Is it possible yet to discern which of the two cabinet contenders has been able to build up the greater momentum, John?
As you can imagine, this has all been talked about in endless theoretical conversations in the lobbies and corridors about whether it should be Douglas Hurd if Mrs. Thatcher bowed out, whether it should be John Major. I spoke to one MP on the right of the party who would seem to be one of the people that would naturally support John Major, but she said to me she felt his time had come perhaps a moment too soon and that she would therefore support Douglas Hurd. But I've heard other right-wingers saying, well, this is going back to the old Toff days of the Tory party. The old Etonian wing of the Tory party has ascended again. And he was saying he came from a South London constituency, a marginal constituency, that Douglas Hurd is the sort of man that wouldn't go down well there. And they wanted someone who had the tough, rough face that Mrs. Thatcher sometimes showed, and certainly that perhaps Michael Heseltine or John Major could show. And significantly, I think you're going to see people coming out now over the next few days in perhaps the way they were more guarded when the Prime Minister was fighting, and the announcement that David Trippier, the Vice Chairman of the Conservative Party, he says he's going to support Michael Heseltine because Michael Heseltine can win in the North, is enormously significant.
Now that everybody's had a couple of hours to digest this news, what is the wisdom about what this has done to Michael Heseltine's chances?
Michael Heseltine was pleased yesterday when he thought he was going to be in a head-to-head contest with Mrs. Thatcher, because he already had signs that what was happening was that the votes were ebbing away from her and coming towards him. I think his camp will realise that Douglas Hurd and John Major will be more formidable candidates because they are going to be presented as the people who can unite the party. And I think you will see some of the good and the great in the party saying that when we elect our next Prime Minister, it must be someone from within the Cabinet, i.e. not Michael Heseltine. So I think he's got a difficult job, but he's got an enormous head of steam going and he's got a lot of support already built up. And his campaign has been fabulously run so far, and I don't think he's going to put a foot wrong again in the next few days. So it's a fascinating time.
John, for the moment, thank you very much indeed. We'll return to you later. With me in the studio now is Donald McIntyre, the political editor of the Sunday Correspondent. Good afternoon.
Afternoon.
Has the Heseltine bandwagon been derailed, or does it have a sufficient head of steam to just charge on forward?
I don't think it's been derailed, and indeed, Michael Heseltine has really had in the last few days what is called in American politics the big mo. I mean, it has looked as though he could have been unstoppable, particularly if the Prime Minister had stood. I don't think it's been derailed, but I do think that the situation now is that all the cards are in the air. It's perfectly possible, for example, that some of the right-wingers, a few of the right-wingers that John Sopel's been talking about, could decide that actually they prefer Michael Heseltine because they're not absolutely confident that John Major is completely on the right wing of the party. Equally, I think a lot of people who voted for Michael Heseltine simply as part of a Stop Thatcher bandwagon may have already wanted Douglas Hurd, or they may switch to John Major. So it's an extremely complex situation.
He will not be pleased that Mrs. Thatcher has pulled out, one assumes. He will, though, surely be pleased that two members of the Cabinet have emerged, since they surely will split the government vote, the loyal vote.
Well, we're still trying to puzzle out the intricacies of this and the single transferable vote system in the third ballot, but I don't think it's right to say that this will simply split the anti-Heseltine vote. Don't forget that in the third ballot, because of the single transferable vote system, assuming that there is a third ballot, then a lot of Douglas Hurd's votes will go to John Major and vice versa. So I don't think it follows that it's any less formidable for him to have the two candidates. The one point I would make is that clearly Douglas Hurd and John Major almost saying, well, vote for one of us, is a less effective message, as one cabinet minister was saying to me earlier today, than Michael Heseltine, who's absolutely convinced who he wants people to vote for.
Can this be the friendly contest which Mr. Major and Mr. Hurd say that it will be?
Well, I think that it probably has had, clearly it's not, you know, to have a leadership contest is not a moment for the party to be unified. The party is divided in a sense in a leadership contest as it never is at any other time. I think some of the poison is likely to go out of the system as a result of these three figures standing in a contest, all of whom could quite clearly work with each other. And I think, therefore, that it is possible. I think there's going to be some serious campaigning on all sides, and there's going to be a lot of politics going on, and it'll be pretty fierce. Equally, I don't think that it's going to be vituperative. I don't think there are going to be that many dirty tricks.
When they do come together, when they have sorted out amongst themselves who will be leader, will there be a place for each and every one of them in that leader's cabinet, do you think?
Well, I think that it's perfectly possible that there will be. I would have expected Douglas Hurd and I think probably John Major to offer Michael Heseltine a place in their cabinet. Now, I think if it was a good place, it would be difficult to see Michael Heseltine resisting that. Of course, if Michael Heseltine becomes Prime Minister, then depending on the size of the... Well, I think, frankly, he has a Foreign Secretary and Chancellor in place. They're both pretty authoritative figures in the party. It'd be very difficult to see him getting rid of either of them.
Let's just move back in time to last night. From what you hear, was there in any sense a conspiracy, a concerted effort by Cabinet Ministers to force the Prime Minister to think again?
I don't know about conspiracy, but I think it was true that a number of Cabinet Ministers, including some quite close to her, did see her pretty late last night and did impress upon her the idea that there was a good chance that she would not be able to stop Michael Heseltine and that it would be better for the party if she stood down. I'm told, and I haven't confirmed this, that this included people like Chris Patten on the one hand, John Gummer on the other, both of whom have cropped up as nominators of the two new candidates.
Donald McIntyre, for the moment, thank you very much indeed. We cross now to the Prime Minister's constituency of Finchley, where we join Polly Toynbee. Polly, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
What is the feeling in Finchley this afternoon?
I think predominantly a sense of terrible shock and disappointment. Nobody here had expected it. They thought she would go into a second ballot. They thought she'd fight hard and they hoped very much that she'd win. And I think they've been stunned by today's news.
Do they understand that there had been such a huge absence, a loss of support for her within the parliamentary party, that it had become inevitable?
I think they felt that support would rally. Her loyalist supporters are here. They believe that support for her would have rallied, that she could have won, and they're very, very sad indeed that she hasn't gone ahead. But they understand her decision and they feel great sympathy for her. They feel that probably she knows best and that she has made the decision that's in the best interest first of the country and then of her party.
Polly, I know that you have your own guests there to whom you will speak in just a moment. You are the BBC Social Affairs Editor. What is Margaret Thatcher's legacy in that area of policy, so far as you're concerned?
I think probably her most important contribution will have been a sense that she added enormously to the prosperity of the great majority of people in this country who've seen their real standards of living rise considerably. She's probably done a great deal for a sense of classlessness in the country, a sense of having moved further along the line of moving the working classes upwards so that a lot of people no longer believe there is really a working class. And yet at the same time, I think some concern that the bottom 10% have fallen further behind. A new class divide between an underclass and the rest of the population rather than between a mass, and which was itself underprivileged, and a small privileged group at the top.
Will she be remembered only with ignominy by the health service, or will she also be remembered for positive things that she's done in that area?
I think increasingly a lot of people in the health service are coming round to see that the reforms that will be put into place in April may well work very well indeed, but it may take several bumpy years to get them in place. I think people are very concerned about what the first 2 or 3 years will be of such an enormous upheaval brought in very fast indeed. Some people say too fast. But on the other hand, the idea that money should follow the patients, that hospitals that do most operations most efficiently should be rewarded and should be allowed to thrive rather than finding themselves running into debt, is, I think, recognised now largely as a good principle, but people are simply worried about whether it's being brought in a bit too fast.
Right, well now give us an idea of who the officials and the voters in Finchley would be supporting as this contest goes forward.
I think that's very difficult to say. I think probably at the moment they're still reeling so much under the shock of losing a leader who's been leader here for 15 years, who's been MP for this constituency for 31 years, that I think perhaps it'll take them a little time to regroup and think again about who, if anyone, they might support.
You have some guests with you, I know. Let's bring them in and hear who they think should take the leadership.
I have with me Mike Love, who has been Mrs. Thatcher's agent here in Finchley for the last 3 years. Mike, how do you feel today? When you first heard the news, how did you react?
Very disappointed and very sad. It's not the news that we wanted. Obviously, we would have preferred for Mrs. Thatcher to carry on, but I think we respect the decision that she has made, and we respect the courage that it took to make that decision for the good of the party and, more importantly, for the good of the country.
How did you first get the news this morning?
I heard slightly before it was announced publicly, but most of us here heard it on the radio this morning.
What time did you get a call and who from?
We had a call at about 9:30 this morning, just from Downing Street, to say that an announcement would be made.
Had you thought it likely, or did you think she would fight on?
No, I think we all hoped that she would fight on. She said yesterday very strongly that was her intention. And I'm sure that's what she would have preferred to do, and that's what her supporters here would have liked to see her do. But obviously she's taken sounding, she's taken advice, and she's made the decision which she thinks is best for the party. And I think we would all respect that, because that's what we want to see as well. We want to see what's best for the party, and we want to see a victorious Conservative Party go through the next general election.
Do you think yourself that she could have seen off Mr. Heseltine if it had been a two-horse race between the two of them?
I think it's difficult from the constituency to say with any great authority. Our view here was that she would succeed, but then we're not in close contact with members of Parliament. We don't know what the feeling was. We can say that we've had enormous public support, enormous support from our own Conservative voters, and support from constituencies from one end of the country to the other. Real, genuine, solid support coming through from Margaret Thatcher.
Do you detect any anger amongst her loyalists at the way in which she's been unseated?
Well, I think the first feeling is just of regret, not so much of anger. I think there's some bitterness that a contest should have taken place at all. We'd have rather have seen a contest not taking place, particularly at this time. But it has, and we now move on to the next stage. I think the important thing at this stage is to remember the achievements of Margaret Thatcher, to remember what she has done for the country, because she has been our most successful Prime Minister.
Thank you very much, Mike Love.
Polly Toynbee, thank you very much indeed. Those views from the Prime Minister's constituency of Finchley. Now to Westminster, to Vivian White, who a few moments ago spoke to the Labour Party's campaign coordinator, Dr. Jack Cunningham.
It is an extraordinary parliamentary occasion, isn't it, John Cunningham, that on the very day that the Prime Minister tenders her resignation, there on the table is a motion of no confidence in Her Majesty's government.
These are unprecedented affairs. Britain is effectively without a government at the present time, and Labour's no confidence motion has played some part in bringing things to a head. The Tories quite clearly believe, including a majority of the cabinet now, that they have to ditch someone they've always said was the best Prime Minister this country's ever had.
Have you not given the Conservatives, by chance, the opportunity for Mrs. Thatcher to make to heroic acclaim a valedictory speech, a sealing of her term of office?
Well, of course, the Prime Minister's got to respond to a motion of no confidence in her government. That's axiomatic, and we fully expect that she'll try to justify what she's done. But what she has done is to introduce poll tax, to create large private monopolies in water, to bring this country, for the second time in a decade, into deep recession. Unemployment is mounting dramatically and terrifyingly yet again. You know, the country is in a very serious state of affairs, and frankly, neither Mrs. Thatcher nor any of her cabinet ministers who may succeed her can absolve themselves for responsibility for these things. They all share in the guilt.
But may not this motion of no confidence this afternoon, of all things, give the Conservatives the opportunity to start to heal the shock of the leadership campaign and her departure?
Indeed not. Because the divisions in the Tory party are plain for all to see. The Tory party is in absolute turmoil. The government is in disarray. If the opposition couldn't table a motion of no confidence in these circumstances, when would it be right to table such a motion? We can't stand by on the sidelines, watching the country slide into recession, being without an effective government, and just simply let these things happen without the opposition presenting a coherent alternative, which is what we shall do.
You're not expecting to win the vote at the end, are you?
No, we're not expecting to win the vote. But all those Tories who've been so desperate to get rid of Mrs. Thatcher could get rid of her today, because if they abstained or voted with Labour, she would have to go immediately. There'd have to be a general election, and that is the proper way to resolve these matters. Let the people decide.
But I put it to you that they're not going to win the vote, as you say, and there may be time for them to do the trick.
I don't think there's time for any new leader of the Tory party to repair the damage to the British economy, to repair the divisions in British society, to get rid of poll tax, to improve the situation in our schools and our hospitals. They're going to go when the election comes.
I was merely asking not whether you thought that their policies would be undone by the next election, but whether they would win it and whether they had time from now until then to win it.
I don't think they have time. I think Labour will win the next general election whenever it comes. Can't come too soon for us.
How long did it take Labour to recover from its divisions over 1981?
Well, that's difficult to say because Labour has had a long period of recovery, not just from splits in the Labour Party. And I know, as you rightly say, that parties that are politically divided are not fit to govern. That's the proper judgment of the people. That's why the Tory Party won't be elected next time, because they seem to be so hopelessly divided. There has to be a general election by mid-1992 at the very latest. I don't think there's any hope of the Tories recovering in that timescale, whoever emerges as their leader.
John Cunningham, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Dr. Jack Cunningham speaking a few moments ago, and of course in 40 minutes that no confidence motion proposed by the Labour Party will commence in the Commons. We can go back to Vivian White at Westminster now. He's with the former Liberal leader, Sir David Steele. Well, they're clearly not quite ready for us, so let me once again turn to you, Donald McIntyre. We've had a list of supporters for Douglas Hurd. Douglas Hurd's office is saying that he has the support of Kenneth Clark, Malcolm Rifkind, Chris Patten and Tom King, so four cabinet ministers there, and three junior ministers, Linda Chalker, Virginia Bottomley and John Patten. That's not a bad start. I mean, he's off to a strong start.
It's not a bad start at all, I think. It's a fairly formidable, though relatively short, list of cabinet ministers, which could well grow. I think Ken Clark is quite significant. Ken Clark's a figure who has had his problems in the health ministry, but curiously enough, by taking the doctors on head on, has actually earned quite a reputation among the right of the party, although he's always been associated with the left of the party. I think that's a very useful supporter for Douglas Hurd, and it does suggest he's getting the centre of the party behind him.
Now, what endorsements would John Major be hoping for and looking for?
Well, he's already got, of course, in his proposer and seconder, John Gummer and Norman Lamont, his chief secretary, who is perhaps a little closer in his views on Europe to those of the Prime Minister than John Major himself is. So that's good, in a sense, for the anti-Europeans. Obviously, the big and interesting question is whether, as some people expect, the Prime Minister herself may let it be known that she, of the three candidates, prefers John Major, and we'll have to see. I'm told that Norman Tebbit was very tempted to run in the contest if John Major hadn't stood in the contest. In other words, if it had just been Douglas Hurd and Michael Heseltine. So one would certainly expect some right-wing support for John Major.
Prime Minister, one senses, isn't going to endorse anybody.
Well, I mean, these things can be done in all sorts of ways. I mean, whether she is going to make a declaration, I think, is very doubtful. There are other ways of indicating these things.
Donald, thank you. We cross back to Downing Street to Andrew Cassels.
Yes, and you join us here at the Whitehall end of Downing Street, where there has been a sizeable crowd for some considerable time. The Prime Minister left here, left the back entrance, as we know, about half an hour ago. But all afternoon, there's been a sizeable crowd gathering here. As you'll probably see behind me, there's been a sizeable group of socialist workers who've been adding a rather tuneful protest to the events, today's events. And with me behind me are some people who've been here for some considerable time. So I'm going to ask them how they view the situation. So you've been here now for how long?
Approximately 2.5 hours. I'm glad she's resigned, but I do feel some sympathy for her today. I think it's very sad the manner in which she's left.
Do you think she should have gone earlier than that?
I think she should have gone earlier, and it's sad this comes to this situation. But there are now three very good candidates in the field, and I'm looking forward to see who's the next leader of the Conservative Party.
What do you think of the candidates that have put their names forward?
I think their policies are basically very similar. They're all very, very good candidates. And I think any one of those three would be a very good leader.
But your overall feeling standing outside Downing Street, I know you told me earlier on you wanted to see a bit of history. Well, you've seen it.
It is an incredible moment in British political history to see a Prime Minister resign after 11 and a half years in power. It was a very, very sort of moving moment, actually.
What about you, sir? You've been here for some time as well. Why did you come down?
I was thought it'd be very interesting to be here, as the gentleman said, for its history as well. But I'd just like to be here as a Labour supporter. I think that it's very good for Labour, and that in the election that she has with the runners, that will split the Tory party, and hopefully it will keep that way until the next general election.
So from what you're saying, you're obviously not sorry to see her go, but
I'm glad to see her go. I'm overjoyed, I'm over the moon to see. I'm glad to see her go.
Do you think she should have gone a little earlier?
About 9 years ago? I believe she should have went as... I think what she'd done in Paris by making the statement that was so soon after the result of the election was very wrong. I think she should have waited for something to happen from that.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, there's just a snap feeling of the view here at the Whitehall end of Downing Street. Now back to Nicholas Witchell in the studio.
Thank you very much indeed. Bystanders at the comings and goings at Downing Street, just a short distance away from them, is Vivian White at Westminster, who we hope we can join now as he speaks to the former Liberal leader, Sir David Steele.
Thanks very much, Nicholas. I'm sorry about the technical problems earlier. Sir David, an extraordinary occasion this afternoon, a combination of a political occasion and a parliamentary occasion. Never seen anything like it.
No, I've been through Harold Wilson's resignation. I've been through the no-confidence debate, which led to the Lib-Lab pact. But I think this is a sort of combination of these two and more.
Do you think Labour was wise or unwise to move a motion of no confidence?
I think they were very unwise. They have also been very unlucky to have the Prime Minister announce a resignation just before the debate takes place. I mean, that they couldn't have foreseen. But it seemed to me an error of judgment. One gets the impression more and more about the Labour Party nowadays that people sit around in a small room and think up a good wheeze. And this is what the Labour Party is about, good wheezes. And they thought, what a jolly good idea. We'll put down a motion of no confidence in the middle of the Tory leadership ballot. It has rather backfired on them.
So what has the occasion now become politically, in your view?
I think it becomes a valedictory address by Margaret Thatcher. And you see the conflicting emotions are going to be quite strong in the debate this afternoon, because all those who are really quite relieved to see her go, and I include myself among the number, will nevertheless say, well, this is her last speech as Prime Minister, and she will therefore get, I think, a pretty universal approval and hearing and respect. And I think in these circumstances, to try to move a motion of no confidence is going to be very difficult. I actually feel quite sorry for Neil Kinnock being landed with this now, but they made it themselves.
So the very occasion on which she and her government might most have been under fire becomes an occasion when the whole Commons, you think, both sides too, even Labour benches, may be moved to some sort of sympathy for her.
Well, I think I wouldn't speak for certainly
all. Labour have been speaking in public.
No, I wouldn't. No, some of them have not. Indeed, I've been rather surprised at the tone of some of the Labour Party's comments. But I think public opinion is pretty fair on these things. I mean, most people have wanted to see the back of her, but now that she's gone, they feel, well, let her go with a certain amount of dignity and bid a fond farewell. And I think that there will be a lot of people in both sides of the House who will feel that. So I don't think it's going to be a great success in terms of an opposition attack. I could be proved wrong, but I don't think I will be.
Who do you most fear as her successor?
I have no views on that at all. I mean, I told you yesterday that I believe Douglas Hurd would come through, and I think I'm nearer to being right on that today than I was yesterday. But I think he would be the best qualified of the three people. Whether he's the strongest person to lead them in an election campaign, it's a matter for the Tories. I mean, it doesn't make any difference to us, because in the end, whoever leads the Tory party has got to defend their record at the next election. That's what they'll be judged on.
But hasn't the new leader the opportunity to start, as it were, with a clean sheet?
Well, it's an interesting point. I mean, the new leader can do one of two things. New leader could either say, here am I, new leader, lots of publicity, interest, excitement, freshness, let's have a quick election. Or he can say, as Alec Douglas Hume did in a similar situation in 1963, I've just become Prime Minister, I'm going to run through to the end of the Parliament, in which case the election will be off for another 18 months. I don't think there'll be any halfway house between these two points.
Last question, David. This is an extraordinary political event, is it not, which has actually been prompted by events in Parliament. It was speeches in Parliament, it was answers in Parliament by Mrs. Thatcher, a speech by Sir Geoffrey Howe, which took us from there to here.
I think it was the Geoffrey Howe reaction to what she did and the end of his patience that has brought about today's events. And I think that perhaps we're tending to forget, in the midst of the excitement of today, the part that Geoffrey Howe has played in all this, a very considerable one.
So this was a departure which began and has ended because of Parliament.
And that's right.
The time is 3 o'clock. MPs are gathering at Westminster to hear Margaret Thatcher make one of the final Prime Minister's question times of her 11-and-a-half-year premiership. She will then make what is likely to be one of her last major speeches as Prime Minister when she replies to the opposition's motion of no confidence in her government. She told the Cabinet this morning that she had decided not to contest the second round of the Conservative leadership contest for the sake of what she called party unity and their prospects at the general election. Two Cabinet colleagues have declared that they are to stand, the Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd, who's been nominated by the Defence Secretary Tom King and seconded by the Environment Secretary Chris Patten, and the Chancellor of the Exchequer, John Major, who's been nominated by the Agriculture Minister, John Gummer, and seconded by the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, Norman Lamont. They will contest the leadership, of course, with Michael Heseltine, who has said that he welcomes the Prime Minister's decision to step aside and open up the contest.
First to hear the decision that Mrs. Thatcher had slept on overnight were Peter Morrison, her parliamentary private secretary, and John Wakeham, her newly appointed campaign manager. By now, 7:30, the palace had been informed, but cabinet ministers, gathering at 9, were still in the dark. They told her she'd have their support in a second ballot, but they weren't sure she'd win it. The Prime Minister said it was a funny old world. She'd won 3 elections, had the overwhelming support of the party in the country, but her future was still in doubt. She'd go.
This is a typically brave and selfless decision by the Prime Minister. Once again, Margaret Thatcher has put her country's and party's interests before personal considerations. This will allow the party to elect a new leader who will unite the party and build upon her immense successes.
Flowers arrived at Downing Street, perhaps in hurried commiseration. But colleagues said the Prime Minister had struck a dignified and not a tragic figure.
Well, her mood is like always. She does her duty. She's, of course, she's sad. Of course, she's sad. But she has remarkable powers of recovery. And I've had a look at the speech for this afternoon, and it's a pretty good speech.
In Cabinet, both during the Cabinet itself, obviously I was there, and in the short informal gathering thereafter, as colleagues who'd soldiered together for many years together sat over a cup of coffee reflecting on events before we went out to resume the fight to get this party and this government back on the rails and to continue the work that we've been devoting ourselves to for so long.
Mrs. Thatcher finally emerged at 12:30 to drive to Buckingham Palace and formally notify the Queen she would stand down. For some Tory backbenchers, it was an era that had to end now. For others, political treason.
I am horrified. I am disgusted with the Tory party. I think it's tantamount to committing political suicide that we have put on one side and forced to resign the greatest political leader in the United Kingdom this century.
Everyone has recognised that perhaps the time has come for change. And I think Mrs. Thatcher actually has helped the party out tremendously by not forcing a second ballot, at which I think she will probably have been defeated.
As nominations for next week's second round closed, the man Mrs. Thatcher decided not to risk fighting again arrived at a memorial service for Lady Hume, wife of a former Prime Minister. So too did Sir Geoffrey Howe, who had no comment on the resignation his dramatic speech condemning Mrs. Thatcher had helped to precipitate. Very shortly, the Prime Minister will give her own account of why she stepped down in the House of Commons no confidence vote. Certain now, though, that she'll be leaving her home for 11 years in any event.
Well, the 3 leadership contenders can now begin campaigning in earnest for next Tuesday's election. But all of them have expressed their regret that Mrs. Thatcher has decided to stand down.
The news took everyone by surprise, not least Michael Heseltine, who was due at London Zoo at a child's tree planting. He delayed his appearance by 15 minutes to collect his thoughts and then spoke at a chaotic impromptu news conference.
The resignation about which we've just heard now opens the way for an election for the vacancy of leader of the Conservative Party, which will enable others to come forward. I very much welcome that. I would expect my own name to be still there, as it has already been nominated, and we will then find a way of uniting the Conservative Party and going on to win the next general election.
But Mr. Heseltine now finds himself involved in a 3-way battle with the Foreign Secretary, Douglas Hurd, and the Chancellor of the Exchequer, John Major. And while he welcomes the competition, it will now be tougher for him to win. Douglas Hurd had until recently almost ruled himself out as a prime ministerial contender. But in today's extraordinary circumstances, he threw his hat into the ring shortly before nominations closed.
The Prime Minister announced a very sad decision this morning. I believe the overriding need now is for the Conservative Party to find a leader who can unite it in handling present problems and in winning the next general election. That's the message coming in from Conservatives in all parts of the party, all parts of the country. Division can spell disaster. I believe that I can do that, and that is why I'm putting my name forward. I can believe that I can unite the party in handling present problems and in winning the next general election.
John Major has hit the political heights in a remarkably short time, moving through several posts, including a brief spell as Foreign Secretary, before replacing the departing Nigel Lawson as Chancellor. This was his statement earlier this afternoon on his candidacy for the top office.
Well, let me say firstly that I'm extremely sorry that the Prime Minister has decided to resign. She had my full support in the first ballot. I had seconded her for the second ballot, and I'm sorry that she has taken the decision in the interests of unity in the party that she is not to go on. I think she will be seen by history as a very great Prime Minister indeed, with a very considerable number of achievements. I think our job now is to try and build on those achievements. I believe I would like the opportunity of trying to unite the party. A lot of colleagues have suggested to me that I may be able to do so. And so I have decided to let my name go forward in the ballot for leadership of the Conservative Party. It is now a matter for my colleagues to decide.
To win outright, one of these candidates will have to get 187 votes on next Tuesday's second ballot.
The three contenders for the leadership of the Conservative Party, the politician they all seek to succeed, is now at Westminster, and for the first of this afternoon's major events in the House of Commons, we now rejoin Vivian White at the Palace of Westminster.
Thank you, and welcome to Westminster on a day the like of which no one can remember. On the very day that Mrs. Thatcher's tendered her resignation to the Queen, she'll still be answering Prime Minister's questions at 3:15, then there'll be a statement on the Gulf from Defence Secretary Tom King, and after that, business questions to the Leader of the House, John McGregor. And finally, the debate on the motion of no confidence in Her Majesty's government, which will be moved by Mr. Kinnock, and to which Mrs. Thatcher, on the day of her own resignation, will reply. Margaret Thatcher's not yet in the chamber, but she may arrive at any minute. With me now is John Cole, our political editor. John Cole, have you learnt any more now of the circumstances which took Mrs. Thatcher from "I'll fight and I'll win" to her resignation?
Well, I've learnt the more detail of the meetings which she had with her ministers last night with members of the cabinet. There were about five of them who indicated to her that she should go and that they would not find themselves able to campaign for her over the weekend. The names are a bit uncertain, but I think they include Chris Patten, Malcolm Rifkind, Norman Lamont and Kenneth Clark. Then there were another group of seven ministers who said that if she insisted on going on, they would not come out against that, but that they thought she would be very unwise to do so. There were some loyalist ministers, obviously, but she was getting an overwhelming body of advice that she should go. And there is rumour that some ministers threatened to resign, and that, of course, would really have undermined the government. And it was in those circumstances that Mrs. Thatcher thought it would be better for herself and no doubt for her party to go.
Straight to the House.
Mrs. Thatcher has just come to take her place. Tory MPs on their feet, standing, waving their order papers, almost all of them on their feet. Total. So Mrs. Thatcher sits in her place, waiting to take her last but one Prime Minister's questions. We're at the moment on Northern Ireland questions, Speaker trying to call for order.
Unseemly indeed. That's unseemly. Mr. Roy Biggs!
Already, as we've been going through Northern Ireland questions, there have been tributes to Mrs. Thatcher from Kevin McNamara from the Labour front bench, praising her work on the Anglo-Irish agreement and the fact that she stuck to it. Peter Brook, the Northern Ireland secretary, said that Mrs. Thatcher had had a most distinguished premiership. It's been a very noisy Northern Ireland questions, frequently the Speaker having to call for order. Now we'll just listen to the last couple of minutes, last 5 minutes of Northern Ireland questions before Mrs. Thatcher answers her questions.
Resignation.
As far as the extraordinary political scenes you saw there in the chamber as Margaret Thatcher arrived on the very day of her resignation, Conservative MPs waving their order papers. Gerry Neal, MP who's with us now, was until yesterday a member of the campaign team for her re-election. With what emotions did you see that scene?
Well, I felt a degree of sadness, and also I have to say a touch of shame that we should have inflicted such a humiliation on her and on the party and on the country for what we've done in causing her resignation today.
Do you think Conservative MPs have yet come to terms with what's taken place?
I don't think so. I think that there were some that quite clearly knew the danger of what they were doing in the ballot, but I think many, and certainly the majority, are just completely bemused now and are looking at the situation with the three new candidates, or the two new candidates, plus the previous candidate in the race.
Regardless of whom you may support and they may support, how long do you think it may take your party to recover from this?
Well, I think that one should, while remembering that we've had a quite formidable Prime Minister, there's no two ways about it, we have nevertheless got three very, very strong candidates in the field now. They've distinguished themselves in various ways. And I've no doubt that whichever one emerges will then command the support of the House, or the parliamentary party in the House, really quite quickly. And it's surprising how these things begin to knit together. But the party has been very strongly aroused, not only in the House, but across the country, about what has happened. And I think that will take some quietening down, but it will happen.
You talk of quietening down. Alan Clark, the Defence Procurement Minister, told us this morning on BBC, he told us that he could never forgive Michael Heseltine. He's not the only one, is he?
No, I mean, the feelings are running high at the moment, and I, deep inside me, I feel a great storm of anger about what has happened, and also, as I say, a real sense of shame about what we've inflicted. But one has to remember that these emotions aren't well played in these circumstances. We have to remember we have now a new situation. The party is in government. We have a responsibility to govern the country. And it's only right and proper that we should direct our energies and our emotions now to finding a new leader. And I've not the slightest doubt Mrs. Thatcher would wish us to do that.
Who do you think is fit to carry the Thatcherite banner, Mr. Neil?
Well, I would guess that of the three, it's more likely to be John Major that would attract most of the support from the Thatcher followers. It's difficult to say. My guess is at the moment, and from my own part, I've yet to make my mind up what to do because I'm still recoiling from the situation. But
oh, that wasn't an endorsement?
No.
That was just a sense, a feeling?
There's a sense, I think, that from what I can judge, that there are some that, in some real measure, who are going to move from having supported Mrs. Thatcher to going to John Major. And I would guess that quite a number would come over from having supported Michael Heseltine to going to Douglas Hurd, because that was the indication in the sort of sounding operation that was conducted, that was their preferred candidate.
But let me put this to you. If the object of the exercise of her resignation, apart from the fact, the sense that she'd lost the confidence in the majority of her party, was that Mr. Heseltine was to be stopped, then you should have, shouldn't you, two candidates, not three. Otherwise, Mr. Heseltine is going to go right through, just as she did in 1975.
Well,
he started first.
I think that somebody looking at it initially might form that view, but my feeling is that, in fact, there has been quite an interesting liaison between Douglas Hurd and John Major, and I think that they will present a very serious challenge between them, and then a subsequent liaison together to fight Michael Heseltine in the second ballot, or the third ballot, as it will be.
Gerry Neil, thank you very much indeed. And now we go back to the Chamber of the House of Commons.
Well, we're just coming to the very end of Northern Ireland questions now. As you can see, a packed chamber. There were cheers a few moments ago when Mr. Heath came in, and Michael Heseltine is in his place as well. This has certainly been the most dramatic 24 hours. 24 hours ago, just before Mrs. Thatcher came into the chamber, she was saying, "I fight on, I fight to win." She made that statement, and then this morning, her resignation announcement. And now, in a few moments' time, she'll be answering Prime Minister's questions. We'll just hear these last few moments of Northern Ireland questions with Peter Brook, the Northern Ireland Secretary, speaking.
Support of the security forces in the suppression of terrorism.
To William Ross!
Number
19.
This question's about the present level of unemployment in Northern Ireland.
In 1990, there were 94,758 unemployed claimants in the province. Figures show that the underlying downward trend is continuing, and seasonally adjusted unemployment is now at its lowest for over 8 years.
Mr. Ross!
Given, Mr. Speaker, that if one looks from the table of the travel to work areas in the United Kingdom,
we will find that 9 out of the top 11 places are occupied by troubled work areas in Northern Ireland. What failure of government policy does he ascribe the state of affairs after so many years of direct rule? And how long does he expect it to be before the level of unemployment in Northern Ireland is down to the United Kingdom average?
Tremendous hubbub today.
The gentleman knows that the level of unemployment last month continued to decline in Northern Ireland, although it is rising in the rest of the country. That the economy of Northern Ireland is expanding at a time when the rest of the economy of the country is not doing as well as Northern Ireland. And the fact of the matter is that we should welcome that fact and realise that it is terrorism that does so much damage to our chances of further economic success.
Questions to the Prime Minister.
And this first question is, when will Mrs Thatcher next visit Belfast South?
Mr Speaker, sir. I had a very successful visit to Northern Ireland on the 16th of November, but have no plans to visit the Honourable Member's constituency in the immediate future.
Reverend Martin Smith.
Mr Speaker, you will understand that Ulster Unionist members will have empathy today with the Prime Minister because we know what betrayal means. Can I assure her, if she visits South Belfast, she will discover amongst the majority of my constituents sympathy for her views on Europe, for having suffered from centralised bureaucracy. We do not wish to have Brussels bureaucracy.
Mr Speaker, I will hope to visit the province many times in the future, perhaps in a slightly different capacity, and might then come to visit the Honourable Gentleman's constituency. With regard to our policy on Europe, I believe it is one which appeals to most people in this country, and I believe it is right.
Mr. Tony Marlowe.
This is when Mrs. Thatcher will next... this is about her official engagements today.
Number two.
Mr. Speaker, this morning I chaired a meeting of the Cabinet. At 12:45, I had an audience of Her Majesty the Queen. Later this afternoon, I shall lead for the government against the motion put down in the name of the Leader of the Opposition.
That's the no confidence motion. Mr Marlowe has been a government critic of Mrs Thatcher.
Accept.
Order!
Would my right honourable friend accept from those of us on this side who share her objectives, whatever our roles may have been in recent weeks. But this is a day, this is a time of sadness and happiness. Sadness, sadness, sadness for her, sadness for her from the great well of affection that exists throughout the house. Happiness in celebration of what has been, is, and will remain the greatest peacetime political reign of this century. And a day of dedication to sustain and build on the massive achievements of Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher.
Mr. Speaker, may I thank my honourable friend. The same person in a slightly different capacity will be available to serve Britain in whatsoever way it happens.
Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, may I pay tribute to the Prime Minister and to her decision this morning. She showed by that that she amounts to more than those who have turned upon her in recent days. Mr. Speaker, the Right Honourable Lady, I know, considers the principle of choice to be extremely important, and that is rightly so. Does she agree with me that the people of Britain should now be given the power of choice in a general election?
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, may I thank the Right Honourable Gentleman for his earlier comments. In reply to his later question, the answer is no. No more than we had an election when Mr. Wilson changed to Mr. Callaghan.
Is
my right honourable friend aware that she deserves the gratitude of the entire nation for her part in bringing to an end the Soviet part in the arms race and burying once and for all the Cold War? between the superpowers. It is in that capacity that she will be remembered as the greatest peacetime prime minister this country has ever had.
I'm grateful to my honourable friend, both for his staunchness in defence and for his remarks. It was a great privilege to attend the CSC conference in Paris and to sign some of the disarmament agreements and for the new CSC, which really ushers in a new order in Europe and I hope a very successful, peaceful one.
Mr. Ashton,
the Liberal Democrat leader.
The Prime Minister, that many of us recognise that she had to take a very tough decision this morning, and we believe she took the right decision and took it with great dignity. May I also say to her that however wide our political divisions, and they are of course very wide, no one can doubt the special style she's brought to that dispatch box, nor her courage, conviction and determination that she has brought to her premiership. Mr. Speaker, perhaps I might ask her to use this opportunity to offer to the House any advice she might have for her successor.
Leading question.
Mr. Speaker. Apart from the last bit, may I thank the Right Honourable Gentleman for his kindness. May I remind the House that I expect to be here on Tuesday afternoon and possibly even on Thursday afternoon.
Which is the day of the third round of the contest, if it has to be one.
So I hope the House will be as kind then as it is today.
Mr. Teddy Taylor.
This next question about the next meeting of the European Council and agricultural reform.
I raised this matter at the last European Council. The government has played a central role in supporting the European Commission's proposals and enabling the community to table its offer at the GATT talks in Geneva.
Mr. Taylor.
The Prime Minister confirm that jobs and prosperity in Britain and throughout Europe could be seriously affected by an international trade war unless the EEC produces a meaningful reform of the absurd late and costly CAP. Would she remind the bright chaps who are now standing for election that the average cost per household of the CAP is now £5.20 per week more than the total net cost of poll tax per household? And would she finally accept the good wishes and the gratitude of all South End East Conservatives for the fantastic job she's done for common sense, for freedom and for democracy?
Mr. Speaker, I very much agree with my honourable friend. Jobs and prosperity depend upon getting freer trade, and we played a prominent part in that recently at the last the European Council and in getting proposals tabled to GATT. I will, of course, respond to my honourable friend's invitation of reminding my colleagues who are standing for election. But let me say this to him. I shall remind them whether they're standing for election or not.
Dr. Godman.
Would the Prime Minister agree with me that it is absolutely essential with regard to the decisions taken at that meeting that our hill farmers be given the protection that they so manifestly deserve? And would she also agree with me, given the assurances that she has given to me in the past, that there is an awful, a very serious warning in that decision, in those decisions, for our fishermen, vis-à-vis the changes that the Spanish and others would like to inflict upon the common fisheries policy? If she is not to be here to defend our fishermen, will she urge upon her successor that they too are worthy of our defence?
Mr. Speaker, I think for once I can agree with the honourable gentleman. Our hill farmers are absolutely vital to the health of those areas and to the whole structure of those areas. And we have therefore tried to increase the grants available to them because we recognise their importance not only to farming but to the rural areas. With regard to the fisheries question, it has always been one of the most difficult in the community, and so far we've got a pretty good deal for our fishermen. We shall continue to try to do so, but as he knows, there is this vital question of the fishing boats pending, and many, many people will be very happy when that is resolved, preferably to our own advantage.
Damon Lane, Kellett Bowman.
Will my right honourable friend accept from me the love and affection of millions of people in my part of the world who have looked to her over these years with the greatest admiration and delight?
I'm particularly grateful to receive that from my honourable friend. We were at college together, and I think we've been together ever since.
Mr. Greville Janna.
Next question about Mrs. Thatcher's engagement today.
I refer the honourable gentleman to the reply, if he's asked the question, I refer the honourable gentleman to the reply that I gave some moments ago.
Mr. Greville Janna.
Mr. Speaker, may I be permitted to thank the Prime Minister for many personal kindnesses which she has given over many years to backbenchers on both sides of the House. And may I at the same time say how deeply concerned my constituents are that she has left the place in such a shambles. Is she aware that they are desperately worried about poll tax, about the deepening recession, about the health service? They are worried about the educational system and about the whole shambles. Will the Prime Minister indicate who she thinks should take a share in the blame for what is, after all, a Conservative mess?
Well, the Honourable Gentleman always was quite a good advocate. He could speak to any brief, and I don't believe he believed a word of that.
Sir John Stokes!
General Barrister.
Sir John Stokes!
Sir John Stokes waits to speak.
Does my right honourable friend,
Sir John Stokes,
does my right honourable friend not agree that the age of chivalry is gone and has been succeeded by those of economists and calculators? Does she further not look back with pride and satisfaction at all those years when she's leader of this country and the world statesman?
I think, Mr. Speaker, the age of chivalry will not have gone so long as my honourable friend is a member of this House. And yes, in response to his question, I do look back with some pride and some satisfaction at our achievements for our country over the last 11 and a half years.
Mr. Ken McInnes.
Number five.
Sir, the honourable gentleman to reply, which I gave some moments ago.
Mr. Ken McInnes.
May I convey to the Prime Minister the gratitude of my constituents for her visit last Friday to Inniskillen and their admiration for her courage as she visited the frontier post at Derryad, where sadly two of our soldiers were killed a short time ago. How is she convinced of the need to maintain such permanent patrol bases for the welfare of the community? And the foolishness that it would be to remove them or company patrol bases and thus surrender more territory to the terrorists.
I'm grateful to the honourable gentleman. Those vehicle crossing checkpoints are obviously very important to the confidence of the people who live in the area, but that one was an example of the dangers to the army who man them. And clearly, as the honourable gentleman knows, we are taking every possible precaution to learn the lessons from that attack. And I can only say that as I went round on the border areas, one can only once again be very impressed by the courage and bravery of both our soldiers and our policemen who work in those areas.
Mr. Jonathan Aitken.
Has my right honourable friend considered that the voice of a great former Prime Minister could be extremely influential on great issues of state, such as our future role in Europe? Will she assure her many friends in the House and the country that she will continue to champion, that she will...
Order!
Some Labour MPs were pointing at Mr. Heath there, sitting in his usual place.
Mr. Aitken!
My question, Mr. Speaker, was directed to a great former Prime Minister.
Loud Conservative cheers.
Will she assure her many friends in the House and the country that she will continue to champion the causes for which she has fought so valiantly? And will she continue to raise her voice in favour of a referendum on some of the great constitutional issues that may confront us?
Mr. Speaker, what my honourable friend says had in fact secretly occurred to me, that one's voice might be listened to after. I believe we now have a policy for the future of Europe behind which we can all unite. And I believe that many, many people in other countries in Europe believe in a Europe of nation states and in cooperation between those nations.
Statement, Mr. Secretary.
So we come to the end of a unique Prime Minister's question time. Now Tom King, the Defence Secretary, will be making a statement on the Gulf.
With permission, Mr. Speaker, I should like to make a statement on further deployments of British forces to the Gulf. It is now 3.5 months since Iraq invaded Kuwait and has continued to defy the United Nations' demand to withdraw. Sanctions have left Iraq increasingly isolated. The Royal Navy has played an important part in this embargo. But Saddam Hussein shows no sign yet of complying with UN resolutions and ending his barbaric treatment of the Kuwaiti people and the hostages he has detained illegally. Moreover, there are now over 400,000 Iraqi troops in and near Kuwait. It remains the government's firm objective to resolve this crisis as soon as possible and by peaceful means. To do this, it is essential to establish a credible offensive military option. Saddam Hussein must be made to realize that he is faced with a military force which will otherwise compel him to withdraw. The House will be aware that there are now 30 countries involved in this multinational effort by land, sea, and air, and of the significant increases in forces now in Saudi Arabia and neighboring countries. In particular, President Bush has announced very substantial increases in US forces. The government believes that it is right to make a further significant contribution to this multinational effort. My honourable friend, the Minister for the Armed Forces, announced last week that we were reducing the notice to move of army units to allow prompt deployment once the final decision was taken. The government has today decided to deploy an extra brigade, a divisional headquarters, and supporting arms. They will join 7 Armoured Brigade in Saudi Arabia to form the 1st Armoured Division. The additional brigade will be the 4th Brigade from Germany, with an armoured regiment of Challenger tanks, 2 armoured infantry battalions equipped with warrior fighting vehicles, an armoured reconnaissance squadron, a field regiment Royal Artillery, together with engineers and other supporting services. Additional equipment deploying with the division will include M109 and M110 self-propelled guns, tracked and towed Rapier, and 2 multiple launch rocket batteries. Lynx anti-tank helicopters and additional support helicopters will be sent. In all, some 14,000 additional army personnel will be deployed, which will bring the strength of 1st Armoured Division to some 25,000 and the total number of UK forces committed to over 30,000. The command arrangements we have agreed provide for UK forces to be placed under the tactical control of a US commander for specific actions where this makes military sense. On the same basis, the 1st Armoured Division may have a US brigade assigned to its tactical control. Certain key skills required for this deployment will need to be offset by selective use of reservists. I hope that this can be met by asking individual members of the reserve, particularly those with medical training and experience, to rejoin on short-term engagements, and I would be grateful if employers would take a sympathetic view of any such requests. The government has also decided to send 2 more mine countermeasure vessels to the Gulf. These force increases will raise the operating cost of the deployment by £10 million a week, and there will be substantial initial costs too. The formation of a United Kingdom armoured division will represent a potent increase in the fighting capability of British forces in Saudi Arabia. Together with further major American deployments and the continued build-up of units from 30 other countries in the multinational force, the deployment I have announced today is the clearest possible message to Saddam Hussein that there is a credible military option and that he must now observe Resolution 660, end his aggression, release the hostages, and leave Kuwait.
Kaufman.
From the Labour front bench.
I'm grateful to the Right Honourable Gentleman for notifying the House of the government's decision. Will he confirm that these troops, like those United Kingdom servicemen already sent to Saudi Arabia, go there at the invitation of the government of Saudi Arabia under the provisions of Article 51 of the United Nations Charter, on which basis we, on this side of the House and our party conference, have accepted that the sending of such troops is both necessary and justifiable. The Secretary of State gives details of the additional cost. How much of that cost will be met by the government of Saudi Arabia, who are already making some contribution to the cost of British troops in that country? Will he confirm that it is the wish of the British government that the 10 United Nations Security Council resolutions demanding the unconditional withdrawal of Iraq from Kuwait should be implemented by the sanctions policy reinforced by the air and sea blockades in which the Royal Navy and the Royal Air Force participate? And will he agree that those sanctions should be given maximum time to work? Will he assure the House that the United Kingdom government actively supports the moves now being made in the United Nations for Security Council authority for any use of force that may be considered? Does the government agree with President Gorbachev that the Security Council should meet without delay to consider the Kuwait issue? Mr. Gorbachev said yesterday, I quote his words, "There's a need to act and get Iraq out of Kuwait. We must be resolute." The whole House will agree with those words of President Gorbachev.
I'm very grateful to the Right Honourable Gentleman for the welcome that he's given to this. Can I say that certainly we would wish to see sanctions pursued as effectively as we can, and we look to achieve the maximum possible agreement and support through the Security Council in support of the sanctions and in support of the resolutions to ensure the ending of the aggression against Kuwait. I can confirm that when I was in Saudi Arabia, I did have confirmation that the host government would provide free food, fuel, water, transport and accommodation for our forces there, for which we much appreciate. We have also had offers through the Western European Union from Germany, who are offering us help with medical supplies, the fitting out of a complete field hospital, and substantial amounts, we believe, of cash support as well, and we appreciate that, and other countries in the Western European Union are helping. I can also confirm that these further forces, following on the original invitation that my Right Honourable friend received from His Majesty King Fahd, that when I was in Saudi Arabia last week, I discussed the possibility of reinforcements. Both His Majesty King Fahd and Prince Sultan made clear that they would be very welcome. And I'm pleased to say that I think opposition spokesmen and the Select Committee are on their way tomorrow to see our forces there. They are due to meet King Fahd. We've arranged for a meeting with him as well. And I think they will hear how welcome our forces are there and how much they appreciate our response to their invitation.
Order. I know the House appreciates the importance of the debate that follows this important statement, and also we have a business statement today. I propose to allow questions on this statement to run not beyond 4 o'clock, but I would ask those honourable members who feel they could perhaps put a question on some other occasion to do so. Mr. Michael Heseltine.
Mr. Speaker, will my right honourable friend understand that once the government had taken the right and proper decision to support the international force in the Gulf, it was essential that the military capability of that force had total credibility? Will he therefore recognize that the announcement that he has made this afternoon carries the wholehearted and unanimous support of all of us on this side of the House?
Yeah. Mr. Heseltine's first intervention since standing for the leadership.
Can I say to my right honourable friend how much I appreciate him coming and making that position absolutely clear that we stand together. I appreciate and never doubted that we had the total support of this side of the House, and I'm grateful very much for the support, I think, of all responsible members throughout the House for this position.
Mr. David Lambie.
Mr. Speaker, is the Minister...
So as you saw there, Mr. Heseltine, who was the first challenger and is now one among three contesting for the Tory leadership, has made his first intervention in the Commons after Mrs. Thatcher's announcement of her resignation. For her, it wasn't just Prime Minister's questions, she wasn't just taking part, she starred. Sir John Stokes, as you saw, said that the age of chivalry had gone, and it was put rather more brutally by the Reverend Martin Smith, an official unionist, who said, "We've sympathy with her, we know what betrayal means." Then Tony Marlowe, a Conservative MP who previously spoken of her in the public print as having metal fatigue, went on to say that she had had the greatest political reign of this century. With me now are David Mellor, Ivor Stanbrook and Sir Norman Fowler. May I ask you first of all, Ivor Stanbrook, as you are a supporter of Mr. Heseltine, do you now regret how it's all turned out?
No, not at all. I think what has happened is an exercise in democracy. It was necessary, sad, of course, in some circumstances, but democracy does sometimes produce shocks, and that's what's happened. I don't think we should regret it in the long run.
David Mellor, has it been a betrayal of Mrs. Thatcher?
No, I think that at any period, a party is entitled to take stock of where it's going, and I think that one of the reasons why you have annual elections of the leader is for the party to have the opportunity of speaking. We're talking about a government. We're not talking about any one person's right to go on forever and ever. There will be many who will regret what has happened to the Prime Minister, but equally one has to face the fact that after 45% of the parliamentary party failed to support her, that was inevitable. What we now have is the opportunity to make a fresh start with three candidates offering a genuine choice, each one of whom, I believe, will conduct this election in a proper way as between colleagues, so that immediately a leader is declared, they will all rally round and we'll get on with the business of running the country competently and winning the next election.
But that's all very modest language, the language of unity, of taking stock. But you know what it's been like just the last few days, never mind today. Have you not heard what Conservative MPs have been saying about Mr. Heseltine today, Mr. Mellor?
Well, I have not, in fact, and I tell you that I do not think any of that talk should be encouraged if there is any, but I cannot confirm there has been any. What is absolutely clear is that you cannot blame any one person for a situation in which it was clear that whatever may be the historic dimensions of the Prime Minister's achievement, and I believe they are great, and I think the Prime Minister will go down as one of the great Prime Ministers of British history. But the fact of the matter is that there had been dissent running for some considerable time, and I personally think, as a Democrat first, that it was necessary and no bad thing, that all this has been brought out into the open and sorted out. But now, quite frankly, that's yesterday. Today, we have now to look forward. We have three highly experienced candidates to choose from. Each one of us is going to have to make a decision. I've made up my mind, not without difficulty, but I'm clear in my own mind that of those three, John Major is the best choice. I hope that everyone in that spirit will do it, but will manage to say that they think one person stands paramount in their affections, whilst not then feeling it incumbent on them to denigrate the others, because that would be very bad for the party. And I can tell you, I'm having none of it, and I think prudent and sensible people will have none of it.
I'll come back to that in just a moment.
May I say, just as a reason for that, I mean, I imagine we're here because it's thought that each one of us will be supporting a different candidate. I wouldn't have guessed this before coming in, the way people are lined up. I see both Norman and Ivor as people that I've worked with very closely, as close colleagues whose preferences I would not personally have been able to guess before. And we will open up these small points between us for 10 days and then we'll close ranks again and be as we always were.
Mr. Mellor, as you say, we anticipate, so you're a major backer. You're still a Heseltine backer?
I'm certainly a Heseltine backer, because although the three candidates are all very good indeed, I would certainly be happy with any of them as leader of the party and as the Prime Minister of this country. Nevertheless, there is one who has got greater gifts than the others, and that is Michael Heseltine, with his flair and ability and his enthusiasm and, of course, his charisma. He exceeds the others in these respects, and therefore he's going to be the leader who's going to win for us the general election.
Mr. Mellor has, I think, been presuming upon your position, Sir Norman Fowler, upon your views. Are you, as he's predicting then, just because you're the third, a herd backer?
Well,
I'm
not actually that, and no one is in a better position to know that position than you yourself, because you've already asked me that question three times standing out on the green.
But that was this morning.
That was this morning, and strangely enough... Strangely enough, there are some politicians who don't actually change their answer between the morning and the afternoon.
Mrs. Thatcher changed hers very dramatically between yesterday and today.
That was after seeing the whole of the cabinet and having it put to them. But my position is quite simple. I voted for Margaret Thatcher on the first ballot. I would have voted for her on the second ballot. And I think that this is a day that belongs essentially to Margaret Thatcher, and I have no intention whatsoever of making a decision on who I'm going to back next time on this day.
So Mr. Miller was wrong in his cynical assumption that because he was backing Mr. Major and he was backing Mr. Heseltine, you were backing Mr.
Hurd. He wasn't making a cynical assumption. He was making a light aside, which I think you're slightly making a bit of
Mr. Miller was saying earlier on that he thought this was a time for taking stock and not for saying things that might make the situation worse. I paraphrase what he was saying. But I'll tell you what it was that was said to me. Alan Clark, the Defence Procurement Minister, said to me on the programme this morning to which you're referring that he would never forgive Mr. Heseltine, and he's not the only person who's spoken to us in that way.
Can I say this? I don't know if David was, but I was certainly here in 74, 75, and we had a bitter contest there between Margaret Thatcher and Ted Heath. And there were some of the same passions, not perhaps quite the same passions, which were raised then. The only way that this party is going to win the next election and do that do it successfully is by keeping together. There will be some people who take that view. If I may say so, if that is Alan Clark's position, I do not regard that as in any way typical of the parliamentary party, and certainly there is no future for any party having that as a policy. There are obviously things to be healed. I am one of the people who has argued consistently. I don't agree with David on this. I've argued consistently against having an election. I think the election was bound to end in tears, and it has ended in tears, and it's going to take some time to put the party back together again. There's no question about that. But that it must be put back together again, there's also no question. What I would like to see is basically all three candidates saying, look, whoever wins, we support, and in a sense going a stage further than that, all three candidates will be members of the new administration, under whoever's leader it may be.
You haven't said who you're going to back, so I won't presume upon that, but who do you think is the candidate who most closely represents the banner of Thatcherism?
I think that's a very, very difficult question. I mean, in some ways, John Major is recognised as being that one, but for various reasons he is regarded as... cautious, shall we say, on Europe, and his solution, as far as Europe was concerned, was regarded as a good, you know, sensible middle way there. On the other hand, in many ways, the irony of this is that Michael Heseltine's, some of his radicalism and his ideas has they're very similar to the kind of approach and ideas of the Prime Minister herself, of Margaret
Thatcher.
Well,
after one shock radical leader, another.
Well, it's the same. It's a curious curiosity of it, that there's a similarity in the style and in the approach.
And will there be a similarity in the way they run their cabinet?
Well, I think that there wouldn't be that. Before one has a snap answer on that, the presumption of this question, I assume, is that Margaret Thatcher has run the cabinet banging the table and not taking any notice of any of her ministers. I do not recognise that. I served with her round the cabinet table for 11 years. I've had as many battles as I imagine most people have had with her. You win some and you lose some. But I think that to portray Margaret Thatcher as an enormous autocrat who simply banged the table and said, this is how it's going to be done on every issue, I think is just completely fallacious.
Sir Norman Fowler, thank you very much indeed. Tears, but we'll see how long it takes for those tears to dry. Ivor Stanbrook, the Heseltine supporter declared, and David Mellor, a declared supporter of John Major, thank you all very much indeed. Later on this afternoon here at Westminster, the motion of no confidence. But now it's time for the news from Nicholas Witchell before this debate continues.
Margaret Thatcher is making one of her last appearances in the House of Commons as Prime Minister after her decision this morning to resign once the Conservative Party chooses a successor to her. During Prime Minister's questions, she accepted tributes, refused to call a general election, and said she hoped that her voice might still be listened to. In a few minutes, she will make probably her last major speech as Prime Minister when she replies to the opposition's motion of no confidence in the government. This morning, she told the Cabinet that she would not stand in the second ballot of the party leadership after all, for the sake of what she called party unity and its prospects at the general election. Two Cabinet colleagues have declared that they are to stand. They're the Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd and the Chancellor John Major. They will contest the leadership with Michael Heseltine, who has said that he welcomes the Prime Minister's decision to step aside and open up the contest.
First to hear the decision that Mrs. Thatcher had slept on overnight were Peter Morrison, her Parliamentary Private Secretary, and John Wakeham, her newly appointed campaign manager. By now, 7:30, the palace had been informed, but Cabinet ministers, gathering at 9, were still in the dark. They told her she'd have their support in a second ballot, but they weren't sure she'd win it. The Prime Minister said it was a funny old world. She'd won 3 elections, had the overwhelming support of the party in the country, but her future was still in doubt. She'd go.
This is a typically brave and selfless decision by the Prime Minister. Once again, Margaret Thatcher has put her country's and party's interests before personal considerations. This will allow the party to elect a new leader who will unite the party and build upon her immense successes.
Flowers arrived at Downing Street, perhaps in hurried commiseration. But colleagues said the Prime Minister had struck a dignified and not a tragic figure.
Well, her mood is, like always, she does her duty. She's, of course she's sad, of course she's sad, but she has remarkable powers of recovery. And I've had a look at the speech for this afternoon, and it's a pretty good speech.
In Cabinet, both during the Cabinet itself, obviously I was there, and in the short informal gathering thereafter, as colleagues who'd soldiered together for many years together sat over a cup of coffee reflecting on events before we went out to resume the fight to get this party and this government back on the rails and to continue the work that we've been devoting ourselves to for so long.
Mrs. Thatcher finally emerged at 12:30 to drive to Buckingham Palace and formally notify the Queen she would stand down. For some Tory backbenchers, it was an era that had to end now. For others, political treason.
I am horrified. I am disgusted with the Tory party. I think it's tantamount to committing political suicide that we have put on one side and forced to resign the greatest political leader in the United Kingdom this century.
Everyone has recognised that perhaps the time has come for change, and I think Mrs. Thatcher actually has helped the party out tremendously by not forcing a second ballot, at which I think she will probably have been defeated.
As nominations for next week's second round closed, the man Mrs. Thatcher decided not to risk fighting again arrived at a memorial service for Lady Hume, wife of a former Prime Minister. So too did Sir Geoffrey Howe, who had no comment on the resignation his dramatic speech condemning Mrs. Thatcher had helped to precipitate. Commons question time a short while ago was far from business as usual for the Prime Minister. For a start, there were kindly words offered to her by both opposition party leaders. Then came Labour's call for a general election now.
Mr. Speaker, the Right Honourable Lady, I know, considers the principle of choice to be extremely important, and that is rightly so. Does she agree with me that the people of Britain should now be given the power of choice in a general election?
The answer is no. No more than we had an election when Mr. Wilson changed to Mr. Callaghan.
Mrs. Thatcher still has to rally her shattered party in the vote of confidence due to start very shortly.
Well, the campaigning for next Tuesday's second ballot in the Conservative Party's leadership election is underway, and the three candidates have been speaking about their hopes of uniting the party after Mrs. Thatcher's decision to resign.
The news took everyone by surprise, not least Michael Heseltine, who was due at London Zoo at a child tree planting. He delayed his appearance by 15 minutes to collect his thoughts and then spoke at a chaotic impromptu news conference.
The resignation about which we've just heard now opens the way for an election for the vacancy of leader of the Conservative Party. which will enable others to come forward. I very much welcome that. I would expect my own name to be still there, as it has already been nominated, and we will then find a way of uniting the Conservative Party and going on to win the next general election.
But Mr. Heseltine now finds himself involved in a three-way battle with the Foreign Secretary, Douglas Hurd, and the Chancellor of the Exchequer, John Major. And while he welcomes the competition, it will now be tougher for him to win. Douglas Hurd had until recently almost ruled himself out as a prime ministerial contender. But in today's extraordinary circumstances, he threw his hat into the ring shortly before nominations closed.
I believe the overriding need now is for the Conservative Party to find a leader who can unite it in handling present problems and in winning the next general election. That's the message coming in from Conservatives in all parts of the party, all parts of the country. Division can spell disaster. I believe that I can do that, and that is why I'm putting my name forward.
John Major has hit the political heights in a remarkably short time, moving through several posts, including a brief spell as Foreign Secretary, before replacing the departing Nigel Lawson as Chancellor. This was his statement earlier this afternoon on his candidacy for the top office.
I believe I would like the opportunity of trying to unite the party. A lot of colleagues have suggested to me that I may be able to do so, and so I have decided to let my name go forward in the ballot for leadership of the Conservative Party. It is now a matter for my colleagues to decide.
To win outright, one of these candidates will have to get 187 votes on next Tuesday's second ballot.
With me is Donald McIntyre, the political editor of the Sunday Correspondent. Mr. Heseltine's office is saying that a couple of cabinet ministers will support him in the second ballot. That's a little bit of a surprise, isn't it? Who do you think they might be?
It is quite a surprise and extremely intriguing. I've been looking through a quick list I've put on the back of a piece of paper of cabinet members, and of course there are quite a few unaccounted for at the moment. I'm very mystified by this. I wonder whether possibly David Hunt, the Welsh Secretary, could be one of those. He's obviously close to Chris Patten, who is supporting Douglas Hurd. On the other hand, he's also close to David Trippier, who was another Environment Minister, now Vice Chairman of the party, who's been supporting Michael Heseltine. And I just conceivably wonder whether Cecil Parkinson, who has been telling colleagues that he believes Mrs. Thatcher was the only person to stop Michael Heseltine, and was strongly supportive of Mrs. Thatcher, might now feel Michael Heseltine is unstoppable.
Is it significant that Mr. Heseltine's cabinet supporters remain anonymous, whereas the other two candidates have quite a public list of cabinet supporters already?
Well, I think, first of all, we have to remember they were all supporting Mrs. Thatcher in the first ballot. Secondly, I think there probably will be a heavy predominance of feeling among cabinet members that they should support another cabinet member, either Douglas Hurd or John Major. But of course, they're perfectly free now. They're not in Mrs. Thatcher's cabinets in that sense anymore. They're perfectly free to take their own decision.
The vote of confidence to come in a few moments. John Wakeham said he'd had a look at the Prime Minister's speech and that it was a good one. She's likely to sweep all before her, isn't she?
Well, I think judging by her performance in questions, which I think politicians of all parties will agree was extremely professional and very dignified, I imagine that this is going to be very much her day, and not the Labour Party's day in that sense. Indeed, I think that although it was possibly a very clever move for the Labour Party to have the vote of confidence had Mrs. Thatcher been running, it now looks a little less purposeful than it would otherwise have done, but it's going to give her a big farewell platform, no doubt about it.
Let's go back to the three candidates. Do you agree with Sir Norman Fowler that of the three candidates, John Major is the one who is most likely now to carry the Thatcher banner?
Well, yes. I mean, that's not actually all that Norman Fowler said. He did say that he was the most obvious one. He also made, I thought, the rather interesting point that, in a sense, Michael Heseltine also inherits some characteristics of the Thatcher period. What's most interesting, I think, about what Sir Norman Fowler said was that he won't say who he's backing yet.
One could feel during Prime Minister's questions, couldn't one, that the party seemed already to be starting to heal, or is that just an illusion?
I think heal may be a little premature. I think we have to remember, first of all, as we were mentioning before, this tremendous right-wing bitterness about Mrs. Thatcher's departure. Secondly, the leadership contest is bound to intensify some of the divisions that already exist in the party, but I think it probably is true that you began to just see dimly how the party could reunite once this leadership contest is over.
Donald McIntyre, thank you very much indeed. In the United States, Mrs. Thatcher's resignation has provoked surprise and bewilderment. Over the years, of course, she's become a familiar figure to Americans, enjoying a close relationship with both President Reagan and President Bush. President Bush is in Saudi Arabia at the moment, and he's paid tribute to the Prime Minister when told of her decision. He said that she was a woman of principle, a staunch friend and ally.
From the earliest days of the Gulf crisis, President Bush has been given only the most solid and staunch support by Mrs. Thatcher. Her loyalty will undoubtedly be missed by the White House, though there's no suggestion here that any of her potential successors would change British policy towards Iraq and Kuwait. During the Reagan years, the relationship was even more special. She was a personal as well as political friend of the president, and a member of the Reagan administration says Americans find it hard to understand why Mrs. Thatcher's been forced to go.
They like world leaders who really make a difference and who stand for something and don't waffle and don't beat about the bush. So I think her standing is very high, particularly during this crisis, as in nearly every previous crisis that the United States has been in over the last 10 years. She was the first with the most straightforward response in support of American policy. In fact, many suspect that she rather led American policy.
On this Thanksgiving holiday here, Americans are only just waking up to the news that Mrs. Thatcher has agreed to give up power.
Morning, everyone. She was a brave and usually victorious fighter on Britain's political barricades, but this morning, Margaret Thatcher is passing into political history.
Americans are perplexed and puzzled that Mrs. Thatcher, who seemed to them so dominant on the international stage, has lost so much support in Britain and in her own party. Most frequently, she's been compared here to Mikhail Gorbachev, strong abroad but weak at home. A few minutes ago, the former U.S. Defense Secretary, Caspar Weinberger, told me he's surprised and saddened by the news. America, he said, had lost a good friend and a close ally. Ben Brown, BBC News, Washington.
Meanwhile, in Moscow, a spokesman for President Gorbachev has spoken about the great contribution Mrs. Thatcher made to Britain's relationship with the Soviet Union.
We greatly appreciate the contribution of Margaret Thatcher to the Soviet-British relationship. It has become very deep and has new substance, and the scale of this relationship has become wider. I think it is a fortunate coincidence that Mrs. Thatcher was in power at the same time as Mr. Gorbachev. We have a good basis on which to develop, and this is a great service which Margaret Thatcher has performed.
Near reactions from Washington and Moscow. The issue that has most sharply divided the Conservative Party and which directly led to the leadership challenge is Europe and Britain's attitude towards it.
At the European Parliament, Mrs. Thatcher's decision was greeted with the popping of champagne corks. Many here had realised the extent of her domestic problems since last month's community summit in Rome. But few had believed she'd give up the struggle for the leadership. One of the first to comment was one of her former ministers, Sir Leon Britton. He relayed the reaction of EC President Jacques Delors, an old sparring partner of Mrs. Thatcher.
I think we were all shocked. The president immediately said that his overwhelming feeling was one of the highest esteem for the Prime Minister, in spite of the differences and disagreements that he had had with her.
And the leader of the British Conservative MEPs also expressed his sadness at the decision.
I think that she was a politician of the 1980s. I think she's a great loss to the United Kingdom. The challenges of the 1990s now require, I think, a constructive and positive approach to the United Kingdom, role in the European community.
Well, while we wait for the no-confidence motion and debate to begin in the House, at Downing Street is Andrew Castles. Andrew, what is being said on the pavement by Downing Street this afternoon?
Well, it's an extraordinary day here, of course, in British politics, and there is a sense, really, that history is being made in a way. There's been a succession of people walking to and fro between the gate at the foot of Downing Street, hoping really to catch a glimpse of the Prime Minister. Of course, they've been disappointed so far because she left by the back exit to go to the Commons. We have seen Dennis Thatcher return. There was a brief flurry of interest. He waved to one or two onlookers there. But really, the mood here is one of interest and the fact, as I say, that history is being made. In fact, one or two people here have been here for some considerable time. Sir, you've been here for a while waiting to catch a glimpse of Mrs. Thatcher. You haven't been able to do that. What do you think of the decision and the day so far?
Well, I'm very sorry that she's gone because I think she did a very good job and I would like to see Mr. Hurd take her place.
What do you think of the way the leadership contest has gone? Would you have liked to have seen her go earlier? Or?
I would like to have seen Mrs. Thatcher resign 6 months ago because I think then she reached the peak of her premiership. And I'm sorry that it had to be this way.
Do you feel a sense of loss, the fact that a Prime Minister of Mrs. Thatcher's stature is going?
Yes, I do, yes. I think, like many other people, we came to rely on her to look after this country's interests, and I think she's done it very well.
Can I ask you, what do you think of Mrs. Thatcher's decision to go?
No.
do you think she should have gone earlier?
Do I? No.
What about this lady is from Belgium.
From Belgium, but I live in England for 30 years.
You've been taking a great interest in this.
Yes,
how do you view today's events?
Well, I'm sad to see Margaret Thatcher going because I think you never had such a strong and good, in spite of the bad things from time to time, but never such a strong prime minister.
Have you found the method, the electoral system, which has led to this rather confusing, watching from the outside?
Sad. I think it divided more than, bringing us together. I say us, and I'm not voting. I'm still a foreigner, but mother and grandmother of English, and I feel I can speak with that.
So you think there will be a sense of loss in your home country that Mrs. Thatcher has gone?
My home country, I'm not, so sure. I'm now, in spite of my accent, more English than Belgian. Or I know more, a little bit about the politics, a little bit only.
So you've been here for how long today to try and catch a glimpse?
I was very near this part of London, and I thought I must go and have a look. I didn't know first that she resigned. I was not expecting it.
And thank you very much indeed. There are, of course, quite a few people here. If I can just come down the line and ask you, what do you think of today's developments?
Well, I think that, of course, Mrs. Thatcher has been doing a very good job, but probably with a new leader, we'll be able to get a different way and maybe a better one for the situation that has been changing during this last period.
And where are you from?
Italy.
So have you been watching the developments with some interest, I suppose?
Yes.
How is she viewed in Italy? Will they be quite surprised that someone like Mrs. Thatcher has decided to resign?
Well, in a certain way, they'll be surprised, but on the other side, they'll be waiting for the new way that this kind of politics could go.
You've been waiting for some time here to catch a glimpse of her. Are you going to stay on for a bit longer?
Hopefully not that long.
You want to catch a glimpse of her before I get frozen. Can I ask this gentleman behind, what do you think of the day's developments? You've been here some time.
Well, it's a shame. I do.
Why?
Well, I just think that she's the best thing that's happened for her, especially Conservatives. I mean, I don't think they're gonna definitely lose, I think. She was really the Conservative government, and without her, I don't think they'd stand a chance.
So a sad day.
Yeah.
So there we are. There's just a few feelings from the end of Downing Street at Whitehall. Very much a mood of a sense of history being done and one of sadness, as we've heard. Now back to the studio.
Andrew, thank you. As you say, a day whose news has surprised and bewildered a lot of people, not least Conservative MPs at Westminster. We return there to Vivian White.
Thanks very much indeed. And as you said, business questions with the new leader of the House, John McGregor, who took his job up after Sir Geoffrey Howard resigned, are still taking place. And later on, the motion moved by Labour, the motion of no confidence in Her Majesty's government, that debate will begin and to be opened by Mr. Kinnock, with Mrs. Thatcher speaking first on the very day of her resignation. But now we're joined by two of her ministers, rejoined by David Miller and the new Secretary of State, Mr. Wargrave. Can I ask you, first of all, Mr. Miller, just taking up from where we left off before, we were told of tears of the wounds being healed. How long do you think it may take before the Conservatives recover from what's been happening to them in the last few days and may happen in the next week?
If everyone is sensible, no time at all. I think a week is indeed a long time in politics. I think what is clear is that the vote that there was on Tuesday made clear that however much one may have wanted to put a good gloss on it, there was deep and widespread dissatisfaction amongst enough members of Parliament that made it in the Conservative Parliamentary Party that made it inevitable that there should be some sort of crisis. I think, frankly, it's better that that crisis can be passed in plenty of time to an election. I think the three candidates that we have for this election now will conduct themselves sensibly, so in a way that once the decision is made, we can close ranks and get on with the job. And I think each one of us has got to make our own choices. But those choices will be made out of respect, I think, for all of them.
How long do you think it may take for the electorate to forget that the Conservative Party no longer wished to have Mrs. Thatcher as its leader and threw her out in office?
Well, I don't know. I think that's a difficult way of putting it. I think that these things, people understand about politics, these things happen. I think that people will regard, I think that people are quite capable of really taking two views. One, that Mrs. Thatcher will go down in history as one of the great prime ministers who turned this country round. But two, that she may not have been the best person to have led the Conservative Party into the next election. I think that a lot of people are fairly fascinated by this week, but I think if everyone conducts themselves sensibly, a lot of people can make good use of the exposure they'll get over the next week to go on and build the kind of reputations that we need in the future. We must work for the future and not just feed off the past.
The new Secretary of State for Health. May I ask you, Secretary of State, what did you think of Mrs. Thatcher's resignation? Did you think she was right to go?
I think she was right to go. I think it was a final, typically courageous and stylish step by her, because she knew that if she went on, which was all her instinct is always to fight, that she would divide the party. I wish the leadership, I think I perhaps differ from David on this, I rather wish the whole thing hadn't happened, and I would have gone on voting for her as long as she was a candidate. But actually, she's done the right thing, yes.
Mr. Hurd, to whom you were number two until just a few brief days ago, said he wouldn't stand against her. Now he's standing. Mm-hmm. Are you backing him?
I'm backing him, yes. It's a rather difficult choice for all of us. We've got very good candidates, I think, who are on good terms with each other. And it's, as David says, I think how we all conduct ourselves in the next few days actually will have a decisive effect on whether the electorate recognises that we are reunified under a new leader and ready to fight the next election. I don't think there's going to be much danger about that because they're all actually mates, these people. I think Douglas has very strong claims and I shall be putting them forward. David, I think, is supporting another candidate, but there's very difficult choices for us all.
He is backing Mr. Major. What do you think is the advantage of your mate then, Mr. Hurd?
Well, the advantage of my mate, he's an international statesman, well known. We have a very dangerous situation in the Gulf, which he is totally part of the international team which has been dealing with this ever since the 2nd of August. I've worked very closely with him and the Prime Minister in that and seen him in action. He's got a certain gravitas, like John Major, he has steel in his backbone. Both of those two are... it's very difficult to choose. I just think he is ready to be Prime Minister and would be a very good one.
But when it comes to the very issue which led to Mrs. Thatcher's resignation this morning, the issue of Europe, the issue on which Sir Geoffrey Howe resigned, starting everything else off, you couldn't pass a piece of paper, could you, between Mr. Heseltine and Mr. Hurd?
I don't think it's quite difficult to pass a piece of paper between any three of them. And as a matter of fact, on that issue, and as a matter of fact, it wasn't actually that issue which led to the Prime Minister's resignation. What the Prime Minister resigned because she feared that she would be defeated in the next ballot.
But the underlying issue upon which you were voting...
I don't know that it really was, because as you say, it's extremely difficult to find, apart from two small groups on the fringes, total federalists and total anti-Europeans, it's rather difficult actually to make Conservatives argue much about Europe. I don't think that really was the issue.
It
was more a discomfort, I think, amongst many people with the style of leadership, which I didn't actually share, but many people felt that, and a feeling that time passes and that 11 and a half years was enough. But it's quite hard actually to make a policy issue. It's impossible, I think, between John Major and Douglas Hurd. It's really a matter of whether you think one particular person has the character. Well, they all perhaps have the character, but is actually poised now, ready to be Prime Minister. I happen to think Douglas is.
Well, it's good to know that you're all mates, but if your mate was elected, he mightn't be Prime Minister for that long, or at least party leader for that long, regardless of who becomes Prime Minister. But if Mr. Major were elected, he might be party leader a very long time.
Yes, he might. I think that's an advantage. I think that increasingly all over the world, our younger generation is coming into play. And I think one of John Major's great attractions is that he is youngish, although there'll be many people watching his television horrified at the thought that one can describe someone young at 47. But he has experience, great experience. I think that's an attractive combination, quite frankly.
Mr. Mellor, Mr. Wargrave, we're going to go straight back to the chamber where Mrs. Thatcher is coming back in, I understand.
Yes, Mrs. Thatcher's just come back into the chamber. We're still on business questions. These may go on for a few more minutes, but the fact that she's come into the chamber is a sign that the debate should be starting shortly. At the moment, as I say, we've got questions going on about next week's business with This Is Mr. George Foulkes, but this may go on for a little longer.
About how it might be avoided, and no action has been taken by the department on these suggestions. Can he tell us when a statement will be made to this House about this tragic incident and what is being done to avoid a repetition?
Well, I don't think I can add much to what I said earlier. I will look at the question of an early statement. I think it may be difficult today, as the House will realise, because of the business we have in front of us today. But I will draw to my right honourable friend's attention the points that have been made by both honourable members.
Order, order, order. Again, I have to say that it's with regret that I have to cut off business questions, but I will call two more from each side, then we must move on. Mr. Michael Morris.
Can I ask my honourable friend to draw his attention to early day motion 61 on EEC bird directives, pest species? I understand there's been some developments in the EEC in terms of withdrawing the restrictions on the shooting of wood pigeons and other pest species. Could he arrange for an early statement from the Minister of Agriculture so that this point is totally clarified?
Well, Leader of the House, John McGregor. I understand the concern on this matter, and like other honourable friends, I've been receiving a good deal of correspondence on it. I would refer my honourable friend to the answer given yesterday by my right honourable friend, the Secretary of State for the Environment, to the honourable member for Rydale.
Reverend Martin Smith.
Mr. Speaker,
this is the time of the week when MPs can raise almost any subject, hoping that they can get a debate on it, but at least even if they don't get the debate, they can at least air this subject.
Can I ask when he is likely to come forward to announce the Select Committee for Northern Ireland, because this question, like visitors to the House, is not going to go away.
I am aware of a number of questions on select committees, I'm not in a position to say anything at this moment.
Mr. Richard Holt.
Would my right honourable friend accept that there's one body in whom no one has any faith today, namely Cleveland County Council, who are always pleading for more and more money and came up with their latest intellectual wheeze of painting all their fire engines from red to vermilion?
I think my honourable friend has made his point very well.
Mr. Jordan Randall.
Speaker, could I ask the Leader of the House also to give very serious consideration for us to have a debate on the National Health Service? Mr. Speaker, not only are we having this problem of underfunding of the NHS, which I think every member knows about, but the book balancing policy at the end of the financial year is causing massive problems in my own health district of Hull. It is not acceptable that we should have this deterioration of service. It's causing very, very serious problems. And we really must have a debate, Mr. Speaker, on this whole question of the government's book balancing policy at year end as a result of its reforms in the NHS.
Well, there may be an opportunity for some people to make references to those kind of matters in the debate which we're about to have, which I think the House is keen to get on to. I can't promise anything next week.
Order.
So now we move on to the debate. Mr.
Cryer.
Except for Mr. Cryer first.
You say at the end of the period when you could tell business questions, which is, you know, is an important time, that you will bear in mind the people who have been standing throughout and whose names are down on the list. I hope you'll do that for next Thursday at business questions in the usual way.
I will certainly do that. We now come to the no confidence motion. I must announce to the House that I have not selected any of the amendments on the order paper. The Leader of the Opposition.
Yeah. Loud cheers for Mr. Kinnock from the Labour benches. Douglas Hurd is sitting along near Mrs. Thatcher on the government front bench.
I beg to move that this House has no confidence in Her Majesty's government. Although I must say, Mr. Speaker, in the present circumstances, there really isn't much of a government in which to have no confidence. Mr. Speaker, for a very long time past, the government has been recognised by the British people to have comprehensively failed. The political pressures have been building up over many months, and they have culminated today in the departure of the Prime Minister. I and my party are delighted to have played our full and proper part in bringing this about. Mr. Speaker, as the months have passed, we've seen all of the signs of division and decay within the government. As ex-ministers have testified, the government is riddled with distrust, just as the party opposite is racked by disagreement, disagreement which cannot be healed under any leader at any time. Yeah. The British people know that, Mr. Speaker, and that is why they have rejected the Conservative Party in every political test and will go on rejecting that party. From the beginning of last year, in the South Wales by-elections of Pontypridd and the Vale of Glamorgan, through the 1989 local elections, through the European elections last year, through Mid-Staffordshire, through this year's local elections, through the Bootle and Bradford by-elections, and next week in Paisley too, the result will be the same. Yes, indeed, an excellent result in Eastbourne, which caused immense grief on the benches opposite, just as much as their lost deposits in so many occasions when they were fighting against us and failing to hold seats. So, Mr. Speaker, the tale has gone on and will go on of continual rejection of this government, all of this government, every time the British people get an opportunity. This government, of course, has, as the tide has risen, tried to take evasive action, mainly in the form of shuffles and shifts that have taken place around ministerial jobs, a sort of musical chairs to the tune of the Dead March. But there was no escape, and there is no escape for them. The whole of their record is against them. Here is a party that has suddenly, in very recent times, discovered that the Prime Minister's conduct of government has been wrong, and that such centralization of power is indefensible in a democracy. Yeah. Yet this is a party which just a few weeks ago was prepared to adore that same system, falling in behind the Prime Minister and chanting at their conference 10 more years. Yeah. They didn't mean 10 more weeks, Mr. Speaker. With such duplicity, who can trust such a party? Who can ever trust them again? These people on the benches opposite, Mr. Speaker, front bench and back bench, who supported and do support the freezing of child benefit, the breaking of the link between pensions and earnings, the reduction of housing benefit, the cutting of training budget, the freezing of care in the community, those and many other policies supported heartily by the party opposite, bringing disadvantage and despair to millions of their fellow citizens right across all parts of Britain. But they've been undeviating in the application of these policies. There were plenty of causes for rebellion, goodness only knows, but there were very few rebels. There was no panic, no demand for the Prime Minister to go when wards were closing in hospitals and schools were crumbling. They weren't striving to topple the Prime Minister when unemployment went over 3 million, or when the crushing mortgages were imposed, or when poverty has been spreading. No rebellions, no panic, no demands for the Prime Minister to go. The only time that the party opposite ever summoned up the strength of self-interest to take action was when they saw their own political careers in danger of being terminated. Mr. Speaker, the British people's lack of confidence in the government comes as a result of 11 years of that misrule. When they reflect on those 11 years, the British people ask, how can it be that our standards of pensions, childcare, training, transport, and much else are lower than those of our neighbours in the European community? And how can it be that this has happened in Britain when Britain has had the oil wealth that nobody else in Europe has had? It's true, of course, Mr. Speaker, that other countries in Europe didn't have the oil wealth, but they didn't have this government and this Conservative Party either. And of course, Mr. Speaker, all of the policies that have so directly touched people's lives certainly have emanated from the head of the government. But they were applauded, supported, voted for, implemented by the whole of the party opposite, and not just the fall woman who has been chosen for ejection today. There are no innocents on the other side of the House. They are all a guilty party supporting a guilty government. There are some people opposite, of course, who will say that there is a great exception to that rule. There are some, well, perhaps I'm hearing pleas of not guilty here. Plea bargaining will do you absolutely no good. Guilty you all are, the lot of you. There are some who will say, who will claim that they've always been against the poll tax. I don't blame them for that, Mr. Speaker, for certainly amongst all of the Tory policies, there is no policy more detested by a greater majority of the British people than the poll tax. They don't just hate.
Order! Mr. Dick Douglas,
Scottish Nationalist MP, former Labour MP.
Could he give us some indications, what advice, in his authoritative position as leader of the Labour Party, he's giving to Labour councils in Scotland who are pursuing people with pending notices and warrant sales for a tax that has no majority in this House, and for a tax which he, if he becomes Prime Minister, will abolish? This is not about time that he indicated. Call off the warrant sales, call off the pending, the poll tax is ended.
I will give this advice to the Honourable Gentleman, advice which I have given him clearly before he defected from our party. And it is this, especially to him as a legislator. He cannot come here and pass the laws and then refuse to accept the laws outside. And the advice that I offer to all who can pay is that they should pay, and to those who cannot pay, I hope that every possible sympathy within this infamous law will be extended to them. I make no fear, no favour in this. The rule is absolute. Those who make the law cannot break the law. It's as simple as that. Mr. Speaker, in a moment. Mr. Speaker, the British people do not just hate the level of the poll tax. They hate the very idea of the poll tax. Because it comes as such a menace to the government politically, they have tried to manipulate it, not to provide a safety net for the victims of poll tax, but to provide a sort of life belt to the Tory MPs in marginal seats whose careers were in jeopardy. Even in that, they have failed. In a moment, even in that, they have failed. The Education Secretary says the poll tax is a major problem on our plate. The Environment Secretary says, we are always prepared, generous as ever, we are always prepared to look at new proposals. And now, Mr. Speaker, there's a new bid in the great poll tax auction. It's called the Immediate and Fundamental Review. or at least, that's what it was called on the 15th of November when the Right Honourable Gentleman for Henley proposed it.
Michael Heseltine, who's now in his seat.
Just in the week since then, it's gone through many changes of shape and meaning. A bit like the Right Honourable Gentleman himself, I suppose, who from about 9:15 this morning reverted to being a stalking horse. The week for him has been a long time in politics. I understand, of course.
Order!
Of course, the changes that have taken place, so far as the Right Honourable Gentleman is concerned, after all, the Right Honourable Gentleman, like all of his honourable and right honourable friends, voted for the poll tax in Scotland. And indeed, he didn't vote against the poll tax bill for England and Wales. So there's some unsteadiness in his position. But in any case, in all, by all means.
Conservative MP Jonathan Said.
Advocating consistency. Would he say whether his membership of CND is consistent with Labour Party defence policy?
We heard a statement yesterday, Mr. Speaker, a very welcome statement in which the Prime Minister had played her full part in securing. It was the most comprehensive statement of arms reduction, with the promise of a new common security policy for the whole of Europe and the prospect of further nuclear arms reduction. The answer to the honourable gentleman's question is yes, yes, yes.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. Speaker, in any case,
order.
Mr. Speaker, in any case, whatever.
Alex Salmon, Scottish Nationalist, intervening now.
Alex Salmon!
Many of us remember the Right Honourable Gentleman's speech last year when he spoke about the idiocy of targeting nuclear weapons on the great cities of Eastern Europe at a time when they were moving to democracy. In that light, can the Right Honourable Gentleman explain how he, as a socialist, can justify spending £9,000 million on placing three Trident submarines on the Clyde estuary?
I'm grateful to the honourable gentleman. He draws attention to the fact, of course, that there is total consistency in the position that I put to the Prime Minister last year about the targeting of medium and short-range weapons on the rest of Europe, and that I'm delighted to see how much progress is being made with the active involvement of governments of East and West in securing progress. So far as the Trident programme is concerned, the honourable gentleman will be familiar with our programme. And it is to ensure that, by all conceivable means, comprehensive nuclear arms reduction and withdrawal is achieved. For that purpose, of course, the effective use of our armament will come into absolute play. Now, the honourable gentleman, Mr. Speaker, is very familiar with that position, and of course, From the puniness of his party and influence, he can't really be expected to play any significant role in the great movements forward that are taking place right across this world. Mr. Speaker, I was speaking about the variety of poll tax reviews that have been on offer. But what is common to all of the reviews?
Now, Jim Sillars, Scottish Nationalist, trying to intervene.
Order. The Right Honourable Gentleman has already given way to two honourable members from those benches. If he doesn't give way, the honourable member must resume its seat.
Mr. Sillars still on his feet.
Mr. Speaker, may I draw your attention to the previous Queen's speech, in which I tried to intervene in the Right Honourable Gentleman. He said...
Bogus!
Shouts of bogus.
In a second... Sir, order! I must hear the point of order.
Will he give way?
The Honourable Member's been here long enough to know that if the Right Honourable Member doesn't give way, he must resume his seat.
Speaker, I see that with the honourable gentleman, history is repeating itself. For it was his party that on 28th of March 1979 ushered in a Tory government, and he's up the same tricks again. Mr. Speaker.
The Right Honourable Gentleman is not giving way. I must say to the Honourable Member, he must resume his seat.
Mr. Speaker, I was referring to the variety of poll tax reviews that are currently on offer. What is common to all of them, whatever their original conception or the motive of them, is the fact that whatever else they profess to do, one thing they will not do, and that is touch the fundamentals of the poll tax. They will not deal with the most basic of the evils of the poll tax, the fact that it is a head tax. That main feature, that most fundamental feature, will not go under any Tory government, under any Tory leader. But go it must, Mr. Speaker, for this is a tax that cannot be improved by tinkering or by reviewing. This is a tax that must be abolished. And the Labour government will abolish it, lock, stock and uniform business rate. Mr. Speaker, no, for a moment, just a moment.
Conservative MP trying to intervene. Mr. Kinnock wants to get on.
Mr. Speaker, the social policies of this government have inflicted disadvantage on millions of people. Their poll tax policies have generated despair and fury. And their economic policies have brought this country into recession yet again. It's a central cause of the lack of confidence that the British people have in this government. This administration, Mr. Speaker, began 11 years ago with policies that provoked recession, eradicated 20% of British manufacturing capacity.
Conservative
have
MP.
We missed a page in this speech? Because I clearly heard the Right Honourable Gentleman.
Order! I think order. The points of order of that kind are not at all helpful. They tend to disrupt our proceedings. Mr. Kinnock.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I can understand why the Honourable Gentleman was so reluctant to hear the history of disaster of the last 11 and a half years. For this administration began with a recession that they provoked. It brought about the eradication, which I thought would concern him coming from his part of the country, of 20% of British manufacturing capacity. It created a huge rise in unemployment. It brought the first ever manufactured trade deficit in the history of this country, which in turn established the basis for the massive balance of payments deficit that we have had in more recent years. A balance of payments deficit, incidentally, Mr. Speaker, that today, the month-on-month figure amounted again to over $1 billion. It's worth recalling, and it is indeed fair to recall, that when the Right Honourable Lady first went into Downing Street, she inherited from the previous administration a £46 million a month balance of payments surplus. The monthly deficit this month is £1.1 billion. That's the reason they should have been protesting. That's the reason they should have been against this administration, but that never bothered them, the trade position of our country. Mr. Speaker, this month is just another in the calendar of loss of markets and increase in deficit. The early years of this government, we are told, were remembered with pride by all who served in that government and supported that government, from Surrey East to Blaby, and from Huntingdon and Whitney to, of course, Henley. Then, in the subsequent years, particularly in the periods leading up to general elections, they let a deregulated, credit-financed economy rip. They called those years the transformation. They called those years the Great Recovery. They called those years the economic miracle. Some miracle, Mr. Speaker, when they pushed the economy back into recession once again this year. And of course, in this recession, not only do we have rising unemployment again, increasing bankruptcies again, declining output again, falling investment again, we also have increased inflation from a government that promised zero inflation. Yeah. What a record, Mr. Speaker. 11 oil-rich years with a recession at each end and a miracle in between. Mr. Speaker, in Britain, we need a different way. We have got to give the same primacy as our competitors do to building and strengthening a modern economy, a modern manufacturing industrial economy. We have got to put at the center of economic policies the commitments to education, training, transport, investment in science and technology and research and development, as others do, as our neighbors do. We've got to create modern employment opportunities and give our young people the means of building a proud and confident future, a future of success. The British people know that must be done. Our people know that it is the best means of ensuring that this country does not go on falling further behind the other major economies of the European Community. This government, Mr. Speaker, has not ever seriously tried to build the productive economy in 11 years. They're never going to do it under any leader. And under no leader, can they resolve the fundamental conflicts inside the Conservative Party over Britain's future in the European Community. Mr. Speaker.
Conservative MPs pointing across at the Labour benches.
Order!
I have to say, Mr. Speaker, there was something...
Order!
I have to say, there was something like a 55% embarrassment in that laughter. Yes.
Conservative MP Tim Devlin.
The case that the Honourable Gentleman and his party have changed their attitude to whether they wish to be in the community no less than six times in the last 10 years.
Mr. Speaker, I only wish that the party opposite would change their attitude so they can get benefit and advantage for the people of Britain from the European Community. Mr. Speaker, the opportunity to try to do that.
Jim Wallace, Liberal Democrat.
Does the Right Honourable Gentleman believe that Britain will gain advantage from a single currency?
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, they, first of all, are going to have to define the possibility of getting a single currency. Point? Oh, yes. But I will tell the Honourable Gentleman this, that by a huge majority, our party warmly embraced as inevitable and desirable the closer monetary cooperation in the European Community. We have further said, as the Honourable Gentleman would know if he were listening to the debates of recent weeks, that in the process of movement there, by all means, in a second, in the process of movement, It is going to be essential to achieve three objectives. One is to ensure that there is in that community, in that development of greater cohesion, in that integration, in that union, They don't like it. Of course they don't like it. They haven't got a policy.
Order. Please.
In that there are firm policies for the convergence of economic performance across the community. Firm policies. Well, if honourable gentlemen won't listen to this, it's no wonder they go unprepared into the intergovernmental conference chamber. But the, I will, in a moment, yes, certainly. Secondly, they have to ensure that there is a growth orientation for the alternative. Is the stagflation? Yes. Oh, yes. Yes.
This kind of attitude doesn't, I think, add to our debates here in the House of Commons.
Lots of amusement on the Labour Conservative benches at the moment.
Leader of the opposition.
For the alternative, Mr. Speaker, to that strategy is the very same stagflation which this government has brought to this country. Thirdly, there've got to be, in any form of union, proper arrangements for transfers of resources between regions, without which there will definitely be a two or even three speed Europe. And also, it's essential, and I'm sure there must be agreement about this in this House, no question at all of an unaccountable central monetary institution, for that would be as improper as to surrender fiscal powers to a non-accountable body. Now, I give way to the Right Honourable Gentleman.
The former Chancellor, Nigel Lawson.
I give the Right Honourable Gentleman, but I think he does owe it to the House to answer the question that was put to him a little while back. assuming that there is a single European Central Bank which is accountable, is he saying that he and his party favour a single currency issued by a single European bank responsible for a single monetary policy?
Yes or no?
Yes, yes or no?
As the Right Honourable Gentleman... As the Right Honourable Gentleman will know, there is no yes and no answer now to that question. No, there isn't. He, I recall...
Order. I now hope we can proceed in an orderly way.
Has spent much of his career systematically refusing to give yes and no answers to hypothetical questions. That is the only answer that's fitting. What I will tell the Right Honourable Gentleman...
Order. I must say to the Honourable Gentleman is one of those who's... Order! Honourable Gentleman, I believe, is one of those seeking to participate in this debate. Nothing disorderly has taken place that I know about. What is it?
Of all, Mr. Speaker, is the Right Honourable Member trying to unite this party or just make us laugh?
Barry Field, Conservative.
Order. That is order. That's a sort of remark, I think, that doesn't help in the middle of a speech.
Mr. Speaker, after everything I've heard from the party opposite in recent weeks, they got a surfeit of comedians. The intergovernmental conference is approaching, Mr. Speaker. In a few weeks' time, are clearly vital to our country. The party of government, and this is one of the reasons for what we are hearing now, is locked in civil war over the issue. We know that over recent weeks, the Foreign Secretary and the Prime Minister have sent very different signals about political process. We also know that over recent weeks, the Chancellor and the Prime Minister have differed greatly on economic union. We can only assume that in the wake of the Prime Minister's departure, there will be a degree of similarity between the views of the Foreign Secretary and the Chancellor. But what is certain is that a very substantial body of opinion in the Tory party strongly disagrees with both the Chancellor and with the Foreign Secretary. That division is basic, it is unbridgeable. And all that they have in common on the benches opposite is their opposition to the social charter and the standards it sets for youth training, social security, health and safety at work, and much else. All that unites them is their opposition to the opportunities for improvement that could be afforded under that charter to the British people. And they also are against the extension of majority voting to secure greater protection for the environment. We are for the social charter, Mr. Speaker. We are for extending majority voting to proposals to improve social and environmental standards. And we are for them because they are means of gaining advantage for the British people, means of ensuring that we are part of a community as well as part of a market. Mr. Speaker, I couldn't really care less about what the Conservatives do to themselves and their party, but I do care about the damage that they have done, the damage they are doing, the damage they will do to the interests of our country. How can anyone, Mr. Speaker, have confidence in a government whose former Deputy Prime Minister admits that they have been pursuing the wrong policies for half a decade? Who can have confidence in a government with cabinet ministers who in the last week have been privately telling the press that the Prime Minister is finished, and then minutes later supporting her position in the television studio before going off to a private meeting in order to contrive the coup against the Prime Minister? What confidence can be given to any government headed by anyone who has sworn allegiance to Thatcherism as every single one of the contestants in the leadership contest have done? Who can have confidence in a government that is split from top to bottom? If they have no confidence in each other, Mr. Speaker, How can the country have confidence in them? Yeah. Both on the back benches opposite and the government front bench, members have no confidence in one another, as they've shown in everything they've said about each other in recent weeks, everything they've done about each other in recent weeks. They are unfit to govern. They should go now. In a democracy, there should be one fitting conclusion to today's dramatic events, a general election. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, let the people decide. Let Britain have a fresh chance with the Labour government.
Yeah. Mr. Kinnock sits down. Cheers from Labour MPs. And in a moment, Mrs. Thatcher will get up to make her last speech in the Commons as Prime Minister.
Our Majesty's government. The Prime Minister.
Yeah. Order papers being waved by Conservative MPs.
Order.
Mr. Speaker, sir, it is, of course, the right and duty of Her Majesty's opposition to challenge the position of the government of the day. It's also their right to test the confidence of this House in the government if they think the circumstances warrant it. I make no complaint about that. But when the Right Honourable Gentleman's windy rhetoric has blown away, what are their real reasons for bringing this motion before the House? Because there were no alternative policies. There were just a lot of disjointed, opaque words. It can't be complained about Britain's standing in the world. That is deservedly high, not least because of our contribution to ending the Cold War and to the spread of democracy through Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. Achievements celebrated at the historic meeting in Paris from which I returned yesterday. It can't be the nation's finances. We are repaying debt, including the debt run up by the party of the Right Honourable Gentleman opposite. And it can't be the government's inability to carry forward its programme for the year ahead, announced in the gracious speech on the 7th of November. We carried that debate by a majority of 108. The opposition's real reason is the leadership election for the Conservative Party. A democratic election according to rules which have been public knowledge for many years, one member, one vote. A far cry from the way the opposition do these things. Two in every five votes for their leader are cast by the trade union bloc votes, which has a bigger say than do honourable members opposite in that decision. Precious little democracy there. The real issue to be decided by my right honourable and honourable friends is how best to build on the achievements of the 1980s. Yeah. How to carry Conservative policies through to the 90s. Yeah, yeah. How to add to three general election victories a fourth, which we shall surely win. Yeah. Look at that! 11 years ago, we rescued Britain from the parlous state to which socialism had brought it. I remind this House that under socialism, this country had come to such a pass that one of our most able and distinguished ambassadors felt compelled to write in a famous dispatch, a copy of which found its way into The Economist, the following words. He said, "We talk of ourselves without shame as being one of the less prosperous countries of Europe. The prognosis for the foreseeable future," he said in 1979, "was discouraging. Conservative government has changed all that." Once again, Britain stands tall in the councils of Europe and of the world. And our policies have brought unparalleled prosperity to our citizens at home. Mr. Speaker, over the last decade, we have given power back to the people on an unprecedented scale. We've given back control to people over their own lives and over their livelihood, over the decisions that matter most to them and their families. We've done it by curbing the monopoly power of trade unions to control, even victimize, the individual worker. Labour would return us to conflict, confrontation and government by the consent of the TUC. We have done it by enabling families to own their homes, not least through the sale of 1.25 million council houses. Labour oppose our new rents to mortgage initiative that will spread the benefits of ownership wider still. And we've done it by giving people choice in public services. Which school is right for their children? Which training course is best for the school leaver? Which doctor they choose to look after their health and which hospital they want for their treatment. Labour are against spreading these freedoms and choice to all our people. They are against us giving power back to the people by privatising nationalised industries. 11 million people now own shares. And 7.5 million have registered an interest in buying electricity shares. Labour want to renationalise electricity and water and British telecoms. They want to take power back to the state, back into their own grasp. And that is a fitful and debilitating grasp. For
Labour MP Martin Flannery intervening.
Lady says that she's giving power back to the people. Those people, over 2 million of them, are unemployed. Has she given power back to them? 10.9% inflation. Is that power back to us when all the rest of Europe? Is the 100 billion of North Sea oil frittered away that no other nations had giving power back to the people? Will she kindly explain these particular points and let us know we're pushing large numbers of people into cardboard boxes and taking power away from them is somehow giving power back to them?
2 million more jobs since 1979 is a great deal more opportunity for people. Yes, 10.9% inflation is much higher than it should be. It's a lot less than a 26.9% that there was under Labour. Yes, we have benefited from North Sea oil, and this government has seen to it that there are great investments abroad that will give us an income in this country long after North Sea oil has ceased. And therefore, we have provided colossal investment for future generations. Honourable gentlemen opposite ran up debts which we have repaid. We are providing investment for the future. We do not believe in living at the expense of the future.
Labour MP Dave Nellist.
If things are quite so good as the Prime Minister is outlining today, why aren't all her colleagues behind her happy to have her continue in the job of defending that record?
Mr. Speaker, these are the reasons why we shall win a fourth general election. In the polls before when we've taken difficult decisions. The essence of a good government is that it is prepared to take difficult decisions to get the long-term prosperity. That is what we have achieved, and that is why we shall win handsomely when a general election comes. Now, I was talking about the Labour Party wanting to renationalise privatised industry. Four of the industries we have privatised are now in the top 10 British businesses. And at the very bottom of the list of 1,000 British businesses lie four nationalised industries. Labour's industries consume the wealth others create and give nothing back. Mr. Speaker, it is because individuals and families now have more power and more choice that they have more opportunities to succeed. More jobs, 2 million more than in 1979. Better rewards for hard work. Income tax down from 33 pence in the pound to 25 pence in the pound. And no surcharge on savings income either. Living standards up by a third. More new businesses. 400,000 new businesses since 1979. Over 700 every week. And a better future for our children. Thanks to their hard work, success and enterprise, our people are better off than ever before. Indeed, the average pensioner, just listen, you might hear something really which you didn't know. Listen, the average pensioner now has twice as much to hand on to his children as 11 years ago. Really are thinking about the future. This massive rise in our living standards reflects the extraordinary transformation of the private sector. I give way to the Honourable Gentleman.
Liberal Democrat Simon Hughes.
There is no doubt that the Prime Minister has in many ways achieved substantial success for the economy. Yeah. There is one statistic that I understand is not, however, challengeable, and that is that over her 11 years, the gap between the richest 10% and the poorest 10% in this country has widened substantially.
That's right.
How can she say at the end of her chapter of British politics that she can justify many people in a constituency such as mine being relatively much poorer off, much less well-housed, and much less well-provided than it was in 1979. Surely she accepts that is not a record that she or any Prime Minister can be proud of.
Mr. Speaker, all levels of income are better off than they were in 1979. But what the Honourable Member is saying is that he would rather the poor were poorer, provided the rich were less rich. That way you will never create the wealth for better social services as we have. And what a policy! Yes, he would rather have the poor poorer, provided the rich were less rich. That is a Liberal policy. Yes, it came out. He didn't intend it to, but he did. Now,
order.
It is extraordinary transformation of the private sector which has created the wealth for better social services, for better pensions, to enable pensioners to have twice as much as they did 10 years ago to leave to their children. No longer the sick man of Europe, our output and investment grew faster over the 80s than any of our major competitors. If you'll be a little bit patient, let me get on a little bit further. No longer a doubtful prospect when American and Japanese companies invest in Europe, we are their first choice. Britain is no longer an overmanned, inefficient, backward manufacturing sector, but modern, dynamic industries. The Right Honourable Gentleman referred to the level of inflation. Yes, in 1987 and 1988, the economy did expand too fast. There was too much borrowing and inflation rose. And that's why we had to take the tough, unpopular measures to bring the growth of money supply within target. Inflation has now peaked and will soon be coming down. Inevitably, the economy has slowed, but we firmly expect growth to resume next year. For the fundamentals are right. Our industry is now enterprising. It has been modernized and restructured. In sector after sector, it is our companies which lead the world, in pharmaceuticals, in telecommunications, and in aerospace. Our companies have the freedom and talent to succeed and the will to compete. I give way to the Honourable Gentleman.
Jim Sillars, Scottish Nationalist.
The Prime Minister is aware that I detest every single one of her domestic policies and I've never had that. It's always a greater pleasure to tackle a political heavyweight opponent than a lightweight leader of the opposition.
Referring to his earlier clash with Mr. Kinnock.
Order!
Who is afraid to explain why, after a lifetime of campaigning to get rid of nuclear weapons, is going to plant three tridents in my country. But can I take the Prime Minister back? Take the Prime Minister back to the question of the poor getting poorer. Doesn't she realise, even at this point, which is 5 minutes after midnight for her, because there was a transfer of resources from the poor to the wealthy, that's why the poll tax was unacceptable, and it's because of the poll tax she has fallen.
And I think that the Honourable Gentleman knows that I have the same contempt for his socialist policies as the people of East Europe who have experienced it have it for theirs. I think I must have hit the right nail on the head when I pointed out that the logic of those policies are they'd rather have the poor poorer. Once they start to talk about the gap, they'd rather the gap were that. Down here. That. Not that. But that. So long as the gap is smaller, so long as the gap
order.
Is smaller, they'd rather have the poor poorer. You do not create wealth and opportunity that way. You do not create a property-owning democracy that way. Can I get back to the industry, to the industrial policy from which Scotland has benefited so much and for which it could never have benefited under the government he used to support and under the political policy he espouses now?
Mr. Sillis used to be a Labour MP.
The freedom and talent to succeed and the will to compete. And compete we must. Our competitors won't be taking a break. There must be no hankering after soft options and no going back to the disastrous economic policies of Labour governments. No amount of distance lends enchantment to the lean years of Labour, which gave us the lowest growth rate in Europe, the highest strike record, and for the average family, virtually no increase in take-home pay. Labour's policies are a vote of no confidence in the ability of British people to manage their own affairs. Yeah. We have that confidence. Confidence in freedom and confidence in enterprise. And that is what divides Conservatives from Socialists. Mr. Speaker, our stewardship of the public finances has been better than that of any government for nearly 50 years. Yeah. It's enabled us to repay debt and cut taxes. And the resulting success of the private sector has generated the wealth and revenues which pay for better social services. To double the amount being spent to help the disabled, to give extra help to war widows, and vastly to increase spending on the National Health Service, over 1 million more patients being treated each year. And there are 8,000 more doctors and 53,000 more nurses to treat them. That is the record of 11 and a half years of Conservative government and Conservative principles. Mr. Speaker, all these are grounds for congratulation, not censure, least of all from the Right Honourable Gentleman, who had no alternative policy.
Order.
I will give way to the Right Honourable Gentleman, and then I'd like to move on to say something about Europe, because what the Right Honourable Gentleman said was, to say the least of it, opaque.
Labour MP Jack Ashley now.
The Prime Minister mentioned disabled people and she is, as always, anxious to be honest with the House. But would she care to give a wider perspective about what has happened to disabled people under her government? Would she care to confirm the official figures that in the first 10 years of her reign, average male earnings in real value rose by 20%, whereas the benefits of disabled people over that period, in real terms, rose 1%. How well did disabled people do out of that?
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, the Right Honourable Gentleman is very selective indeed in what he chooses. He knows full well that in the last 11 years, we have spent twice as much on the disabled over and above inflation. Not twice as much in cash terms, but twice as much in what the benefits will buy, in particular in mobility and, of course, the motability scheme. This has been quite outstanding and has been brought about because we have been able under our policies to create the wealth which created the resources to do that, among other things. Now, Mr. Speaker, over the last 11 years, this government's had a clear and unwavering vision of the future of Europe and of Britain's role in it. It's a vision which stems from our own deep-seated attachment to parliamentary democracy and this government's commitment to economic liberty, to enterprise, to competition, and to a free market economy. No government in Europe has fought more resolutely against subsidies, state aids to industry, and protectionism. against unnecessary regulation and bureaucracy, against increasing unaccountable central power at the expense of national parliaments. No government has fought more against that in Europe than this one. We've fought attempts to put new burdens and constraints upon industry, such as a social charter, which would take away jobs, in particular part-time jobs. For us, part of the purpose of the community is to demolish trade barriers and to eliminate unfair subsidies so that we can all benefit from a great expansion of trade both within Europe and with the outside world. The fact is that Britain has done more to shape the community over the past 11 years than any other member state. It is Britain which is leading the reform of the common agricultural policy, getting surpluses down, putting a ceiling on agricultural spending. We have been the driving force towards a single market, which when it is completed will be the most significant advance in the community since the Treaty of Rome itself. And we've done more than any other government to resist protectionism, to keep Europe's market open to trade with the rest of the world, and to make a success of the GATT negotiations. Mr. Speaker, we have worked for our vision of a Europe which is free and open to the rest of the world and above all to the countries of Eastern Europe as they emerge from the shadows of socialism. It wouldn't help them for Europe to become a tight-knit little club, tied up in regulation and restrictions. They deserve a Europe where there's room for their rediscovered sense of nationhood and a place to decide their own destiny after decades of repression. And with all this, Mr. Speaker, we have never hesitated to stand up for Britain's interests. The people of Britain want a fair deal in Europe, particularly over our budget contribution. We have got back nearly £10 billion, which would otherwise have been paid over to the European Community under the arrangements negotiated by the party opposite when they were in power. Indeed, what sort of vision do they have, Mr. Speaker? None, according to the Right Honourable Gentleman. They want a Europe of subsidies, a Europe of socialist restrictions, a Europe of protectionism. They want it because that's how they would like to run, or is it to ruin, this country? Yeah. Every time we've stood up and fought for Britain and British interests, the front bench opposite have carped and criticised and moaned. And on the central issues of Europe's future, they will not tell us where they stand. Do they want a single currency? The Right Honourable Gentleman doesn't even know what it means or its consequences have been. Does it?
Order.
Absolute nonsense. It was appalling. So he says it's a hypothetical question. It's not going to be a hypothetical question. And someone has to go there and argue knowing what it means. Are they prepared to defend the rights of the United Kingdom Parliament? No, for all that the Right Honourable Gentleman said. For them, it's all compromise. Sweep it under the carpet. Leave it for another day. It might sort out or sort itself in the hope that people of Britain will not notice
order
happening to them and how the powers would be gradually slipping away. This government will continue to take a positive and constructive approach to the future of Europe. We welcome economic and monetary cooperation. Indeed, no other member state has gone further than Britain in tabling proposals for the next stage, including the hard ECU. But our proposals would work with the market and give people and governments real choice. We want the community to move forward as 12. And from my talks in Paris with other European leaders over these past few days, I'm convinced that that is their aim too. Europe is strongest when it grows through willing cooperation and practical measures, not compulsion nor bureaucratic dreams. I give way to the Honourable Gentleman.
Alan Beath, Liberal Democrat.
Will she tell us whether she intends to continue her own personal fight against a single currency and an independent central bank when she leaves office?
No, she's going to be the governor.
On the present structure...
She's going to be the governor, said Dennis Skinner there. Mrs. Thatcher's laughing as well. cheers are taken up by Conservatives, some of them.
Order. The Prime Minister.
What a good idea.
Comes up from Dennis Skinner.
I hadn't thought of it. But if I were, there'd be no European Central Bank accountable to no one, least of all to National Parliament. Because the point of that kind of European Central Bank is no democracy, taking powers away from every single Parliament and being able to have a single currency and a monetary policy and an interest rate which takes all political power away from us. As my right honourable friend said in his first speech, after the proposal of a single currency is about the politics of Europe. It is about a federal Europe by the back door. So I'll consider the honourable gentleman's proposal. Now, where were we? I'm enjoying this.
Thatcher.
I'm enjoying this.
Mrs. Thatcher, relaxed. Conservatives shouting, you can wipe the floor with them.
Yes, I know.
Astonishing performance by Mrs. Thatcher this afternoon.
Order! Prime Minister.
Now, Mr. Speaker, we were on Europe and what is and the socialist ideal of Europe. Not for us, the corporatism, socialism and central control. We leave those to the benches opposite. Ours is a larger vision of the community whose member states cooperate with one another more and more closely to the benefit of all. Are we then to be censured for standing up for a free and open Britain in a free and open Europe? No, Mr. Speaker. Our policies
order.
Are in tune with the deepest instincts of the British people. And we shall win the censure motion, so we shall not be censured for what is thoroughly right. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, under our leadership, Britain has been just as influential in shaping the wider Europe and the relations between East and West. 10 years ago, the eastern part of Europe lay under totalitarian rule, its people knowing neither rights nor liberties. Today, we have a Europe in which democracy, the rule of law, and basic human rights are spreading ever more widely, where the threat to our security from the overwhelming conventional forces of the Warsaw Pact has been removed, where the Berlin Wall has been torn down and the Cold War is at an end. These immense changes didn't come about by chance. They have been achieved by strength and resolution in defence and by a refusal ever to be intimidated. No one in Eastern Europe believes that their countries would be free had it not been for those Western governments who are prepared to defend liberty, who kept alive their hope that one day East Europe too would enjoy freedom. But it was no thanks to the party opposite, nor to the campaign for nuclear disarmament, of which the Right Honourable Gentleman tells us is still a member. It is this government which kept the nuclear weapons which ensured that we would never be blackmailed or threatened. When Brezhnev deployed the SS-20s, Britain deployed the cruise missiles and was the first to do so. And all these things were done in the teeth of the opposition of honourable gentlemen opposite and their ladies. The SS-20s... could never have been negotiated away without the bargaining strength which Cruz and Pershing gave to the West. Should we be censured for our strength or the party opposite for their weakness? I have no doubt that the people of this country will willingly entrust Britain's security in future to a Conservative government which defends them rather than to socialists who put expediency before principle. And it is principle which is at stake. I must
Sir Eldon Griffiths.
Conservative MP, Sir Eldon Griffiths.
Could I offer to my right honourable friend one measurement of the immense international respect and affection that she enjoys as a result of her policies of peace through strength. A public opinion poll published in West Coast America last month gave these figures.
There have been so many opinion polls lately, but not one from the West Coast of America.
Takes a lot of time. And I think the Honourable Gentleman is seeking to participate in the debate. Would he ask a question, please?
These figures. Gorbachev, 74%. Bush, 75%. And Thatcher, 94%.
Labour MPs pointing across at the Conservative benches.
And I'm sure they were quite right too. Now, may I say a word or two about the Gulf? Because it is...
Order!
May I say a word or two about the situation of the Gulf? It is the thing which will dominate politics until the matter is resolved. And it's principle which is at stake there, Mr. Speaker. Principle and the rule of international law. In my discussions with other heads of government at the CSC summit in Paris, I found unanimous and impressive determination that Iraq's aggression must not succeed. The resolutions of the United Nations must be implemented in full. That is the peaceful option, Mr. Speaker, and it is there to be taken if Saddam Hussein so chooses. But there is also a very widespread recognition among my colleagues in Paris that the time is fast approaching when the world community will have to take more decisive action to uphold international law and compel Saddam Hussein to leave Kuwait. No one can doubt the dangers which lie ahead. Saddam Hussein has many times shown his contempt for human life, not least for the lives of his own people. He has large armed forces. They are equipped with peculiarly evil weapons, both chemical and biological. Twice in my time... No, Mr. Speaker, not now.
Order!
Labour MP Tamdiel trying to intervene.
Prime Minister, we've had to send our forces across the world to defend a small country against ruthless aggression. First our own people in the Falklands, and now to the borders of Kuwait. To those who've never had to take such decisions, may I say to them that they are taken with a heavy heart in the knowledge of the manifold dangers, but with tremendous pride in the professionalism and courage of our armed forces. There's something else which one feels as well, Mr. Speaker. That is a sense of this country's destiny. The centuries of history and experience which ensure that when principles have to be defended, when good has to be upheld, when evil has to be overcome, then Britain will take up arms. It is because we on this side have never flinched from difficult decisions that this House and this country can have confidence in this government today.
As Thatcher sits down, Conservative MPs on their feet, waving their order papers, speech from a Prime Minister who's just announced her resignation. Well, Mrs. Thatcher sits down. The debate will continue until 10 o'clock. Now back to Nicholas Witchell in the studio.
A final speech. I'm enjoying this, she said. Donald McIntyre, it was the peroration which perhaps you would expect. Do you sense that it has already started to pull the party together?
Well, as I was saying earlier, I think it's a bit early to talk about pulling the party together, but it was a pretty remarkable speech, I think. She suddenly relaxed after that intervention by Dennis Skinner, which sort of released this magnificent tirade about the idea of an unaccountable European Central Bank. And it was a good speech. Of course, the fascinating thing to think about is that what would have happened had she made this speech and still be running in the leadership contest, and that's impossible to judge, though I fancy that quite a lot of those people waving their order papers in applause at the end were among those who actually voted for her opponent.
It was very emotional, very sentimental, but it also had some important political points. She made sure that her view of Europe was heard loud and clear, didn't she?
Yes, that's right, and perhaps a little more loudly and clearly in that intervention than she might have done if she was having to measure her every word in a leadership contest with Michael Heseltine.
So she's leaving a clear message for the party. You move away from this at your peril.
Yes, that may be right, but of course the fact is that all three candidates in the leadership contest are actually ones who take a slightly different view of Europe.
Who is now best placed to succeed her, do you think?
Well, I think it's terribly difficult to say at the moment. The cards are all in the air. I mean, when she was talking about the Gulf, it did just occur to me that if there is a Gulf card in this, it is striking, I think, that Douglas Hurd as Foreign Secretary, proposed for this leadership contest by Tom King, has a certain strength in that area, and of course he looks like a Prime Minister already. Nonetheless, one should remember that none of the candidates, you could put a cigarette paper between them on the issue of the Gulf, so I wouldn't want to overstress that. But it's extremely difficult to say, I think. The cards are up in the air. Douglas Hurd possibly at the moment by a short straw.
This was an occasion engineered by the opposition, but has it rebounded on them? This was an occasion, surely, which was the Prime Minister's.
Well, I think it was an occasion which was the Prime Minister's. Of course, it was the motion was put at a time when the Labour Party thought it still likely that she would contest it, and I think that's right, and it was an enjoyable parliamentary occasion. The real politics, however, at the moment is going on within the Conservative Party.
We've spoken of Mrs Thatcher's speech. What did you think of Neil Kinnock's speech?
Well, I thought it started extremely well, actually. I thought in difficult circumstances, given the change in events since the censure motion was tabled, it started very well. My impression was that it started to fall away quite a bit after Jim Wallace's question on the European currency, and he slightly lost it then.
Was this an occasion when Margaret Thatcher will have, about which Margaret Thatcher will have felt proud, do you think?
Well, I think she will have had extremely mixed feelings. I think she will have felt proud of it. It is an extraordinary occasion. It's probably her last major speech in 11 and a half years in Parliament, though, as she reminded the House of Commons earlier in the day, she will probably be there to take questions on Tuesday and possibly Thursday as well.
And she seemed in many respects, apart from the trouble with her throat, she seemed one of the most relaxed people there, didn't she?
Yes, she did seem. There was a certain sense of relaxation about her her approach, particularly, I think, towards the end of the speech.
Donald McIntyre, grateful to you. Thank you very much indeed. Well, we've just received the first reaction from President Bush, who's visiting American troops in Saudi Arabia. He paid warm tribute to Margaret Thatcher, both as a friend and as a world leader.
You know of my high regard for Prime Minister Thatcher, and we will obviously work with the next Prime Minister, and I expect that knowing the fiber there, that they'll stay right on course with us. But on a very personal sense, I would express send my best to her at this difficult time. She's been a staunch friend and ally. She's a woman of principle. She's stood for what she believes. You always know where she was and what she believed. And I think everybody in America would agree that Margaret Thatcher has been an outstanding ally for the United States. And I'm certain that this will continue with the United Kingdom, but on a personal basis, I'll miss her because I value her counsel, I value her long experience, the wisdom that comes from her long experience, and she has been an outstanding Prime Minister for the United Kingdom and an outstanding friend of the United States.
George Bush speaking in Saudi Arabia this afternoon. Today's events are seeing the end of the longest rule of any British Prime Minister this century. It began back in May 1979 when Mrs. Thatcher led the Conservatives to power after 4 years of Labour rule. 3 years later, she faced her first major international crisis when Argentina invaded the Falklands. But in June 1982, they surrendered to the British task force. October 1984, and a year after her second general election victory, Mrs. Thatcher survived the IRA bomb attack on the Brighton Hotel, where she was preparing her party conference speech. A record third election victory in June 1987 gave the Conservatives a majority of 104 seats, and Mrs. Thatcher looked forward to leading her party into a fourth election. But today she stood down to try to restore unity to the Conservative Party. Well, Mrs. Thatcher's resignation has brought mixed reaction from those who would take over as leader, from the opposition and from her closest supporters. And in the Commons this afternoon, she again took centre stage.
Number two.
Mr. Speaker, this morning I chaired a meeting of the Cabinet. At 12:45 I had an audience of Her Majesty the Queen. Later this afternoon I shall lead for the government against the motion put down in the name of the Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, may I pay tribute to the Prime Minister and to her decision this morning. She showed by that she amounts to more than those who have turned upon her in recent days. Mr. Speaker, the Right Honourable Lady, I know, considers the principle of choice to be extremely important, and that is rightly so. Does she agree with me that the people of Britain should now be given the power of choice in a general election? Yeah.
May I thank the Right Honourable Gentleman for his earlier comments. In reply to his later question, the answer is no. No more than we had an election when Mr. Wilson changed to Mr. Callaghan.
May I say to the Prime Minister that many of us recognise that she had to take a very tough decision this morning, and we believe she took the right decision and took it with great dignity. May I also say to her that however wide our political divisions, and they are of course very wide, no one can doubt the special style she's brought to that dispatch box, nor her courage, conviction and determination that she has brought to her premiership. Mr. Speaker, perhaps I might ask her to use this opportunity to offer to the House any advice she might have for her successor.
I believe the overriding need now is for the Conservative Party to find a leader who can unite it in handling present problems and in winning the next general election. That's the message coming in from Conservatives in all parts of the party, all parts of the country. Division can spell disaster. I believe that I can do that, and that is why I'm putting my name forward.
I think she will be seen by history as a very great Prime Minister indeed, with a very considerable number of achievements. I think our job now is to try and build on those achievements. I believe I would like the opportunity of trying to unite the party. A lot of colleagues have suggested to me that I may be able to do so. And so I have decided to let my name go forward in the ballot for leadership of the Conservative Party. It is now a matter for my colleagues to decide.
This brings to an end a quite remarkable premiership. She has made a remarkable contribution to Britain's history and has led this country with great distinction in the 1980s. The resignation about which we've just heard now opens the way for an election for the vacancy of leader of the Conservative Party, which will enable others to come forward.
I hate to see her go, but on the other hand, there was that vote far closer than anybody anticipated. I think that what we've got to do now is to bind up the wounds. We've got to elect a new leader who is capable of reuniting the party.
The essence of a good government is that it is prepared to take difficult decisions to get the long-term prosperity. That is what we have achieved, and that is why we shall win handsomely when a general election comes.
Said her conduct of the government was wrong. Mr. Kinnock called for but was refused a general election. Margaret Thatcher dismissed what she called his windy rhetoric. We shall surely win a fourth election victory. We rescued Britain 11 years ago, she said. We have given power back to the people. Now, for the sake of her party's unity, she is standing aside. A chapter in British politics and in British life is closing. She took her decision this morning in Downing Street in the early hours. The Cabinet was informed at 9 o'clock. The Home Secretary said it was the saddest moment of his life. Later, Mrs. Thatcher left to tell the Queen. The man whose challenge brought her down was planting trees at London Zoo. Michael Heseltine said he welcomed the decision to open up the contest to others. At Buckingham Palace, Margaret Thatcher had a not quite final audience of the Queen. She will remain while three others strive to succeed her as Prime Minister. There is a family home in Dulwich which has never been lived in, and a seat one expects in the House of Lords. This afternoon, Margaret Thatcher went to the House of Commons to make a final speech. She defended the philosophy known as Thatcherism. "I am enjoying this," she said. And she said that she hoped her voice might be listened to in the future. It's a funny old world, she told the Cabinet this morning. That is the news so far on Thursday, the 22nd of November 1990, the day Margaret Thatcher announced her intention to resign. From BBC News, good afternoon.